So I'm starting, Ravinder. Sir, Ravinder
Yes,
sir.
ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am, please.
Okay. A very warm good afternoon to all the participants. I, Dr. Sayed Mubeen Zehra, on behalf of ARSD College and my team webinar, and with all the support of our respected principal, Dr. Gyantosh Kumar Jha, I welcome you all today to this fourth session of day two on the three-day workshop on the digital turn in education, a new pattern in teaching learning practices. I'm very delighted and very happy to introduce you to the next speaker, Dr. Sandesha Raipa Garbial. Dr. Sandesha would be talking on the speaking on the topic language empowerment through online teaching. Dr. Sandesha is an assistant professor at Jawaharlal Nehru University, JNU, Linguistic Empowerment Cell. She has specialized in the area of English language teaching. Dr. Sandesha was born and brought up in Dubai, a multicultural city. She did her graduation from Delhi University, Miranda House. She did her PhD from JNU, Jawaharlal Nehru University, in linguistics, focusing on syllabus design for communication skills. Dr. Sandesha has been into planning and development of curriculum in both English as a second language as well as English as a foreign language for nearly a decade and more now. Sandesha ji has expert experience of working with various language lab softwares at both IIT Delhi and JNU. She believes and she understands that the need of combining technology with traditional teaching methods is the need of the hour. She has been the project investigator of an extremely ambitious and interesting project, which is the first of its kind between JNU and ONGC on the area of the topic of that project is very interesting, that it is documentation and preservation of indigenous endangered languages and cultures. Now, apart from conducting various teachers training and communication skill workshops, she has also prepared candidates for various examinations such as IELTS, GMAT, CAT, so and so forth. She has a PhD in linguistics. She has conducted several workshops for teachers training program for universities like BHU and various other educational institutes. Her training is concentrated on English language skill, effective communication skills, gaining competitive edge, online training in interview skills, style and manner. She has an expertise on online methodology, and Dr. Sandesha has a vast experience of traveling. She based on her work also, she was initially also part of an American company on her subject, and she has worked for an international American company. She has widely traveled to Florida, New York, China, Hong Kong, Egypt, Mauritius, Kathmandu, Australia, and I would like to mention here that in one of the Mann Ki Baat of our Honorable Prime Minister, he mentioned about a prestigious and an ambitious work that Dr. Sandesha has been doing. He spoke about the Rang community. It's the language is Ranglo. Sandesha should correct me if I'm wrong in pronunciating this. The Ranglo language, it's an indigenous endangered community. And our Honorable Prime Minister mentioned about her work in his Mann Ki Baat last year. Now, in her own words, I would say that she says that nothing gives the Sagittarian more happiness than seeing her students gain confidence by attaining their maximum potentials. So, my dear participants, I present you Dr. Sandesha Raipa for the next session. I welcome her, Dr. Sandesha Raipa. Please.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everybody. Namaste to Principal Jha. And thank you, Ravinder Ji has also been helping me a lot with the entire thing. So let's quickly begin. So if I have the hosting rights, I'm going to start with sharing of my screen. Right, so I hope my slides are visible. As you can see,
yes, welcome. Ma'am.
Thank you so much, Ravindraji. Ravindraji is going to be my third eye. So everybody, welcome to the virtual world of JNU. And as ma'am said, I am an assistant professor at the Linguistic Empowerment Cell at Jawaharlal Nehru University. Right. Thank you so much, Mubin ma'am, for the wonderful, kind of introduction that you gave. All right. So now, what should you, all of you be expecting in the next 75 minutes? Right. First thing is, we're going to get to know each other. All of you have done a wonderful, exercise of actually submitting the Google form. Within half an hour, I had over 100. And I'm going to quickly share the results with you. We'll have a few activities. I'll be talking about the 21st century life skills. I'll be talking about the LSRW skills and a little bit about art integrated learning, a couple of group activities. And then in the end, I'll show you my sources. Now, I don't know, had we been there in the real world, we would have been able to see how our fellow participants, they were looking like and everything, but it's kind of difficult out here. So I, as a person, generally try to break the ice by getting to know. For me, as a speaker, as a resource person, it's extremely important to know what is the need or what are the needs of my participants. So the age group right now, this is initially when I had only 115 responses. By now, I think I've already crossed 130, but let's start from here. So as you can see over here, 49.6% are in the majority is between the age of 31 and 40. And then you have people. The good thing is, look at the people above the age of 51 and 60. We have 8.7%. And then we also have people who are above the age of 61. This goes to show that there is no age which stops you from learning. Okay. The gender, ladies, you lead the way. 65.2% out of 115 responses are ladies out here. Next, what is the kind of profile that we're looking at? The 86.7% out here, they're teachers, they're university faculties, 7.5% are research scholars, and then we have a few professionals, and we have some other profiles too. Now, looking at the couple of institutions that I could quickly muster up, we obviously have the host college. Apart from that, we have Vardhaman College, somebody from Bijnor. We have people from FN University, Dyal Singh College, College of Agriculture. We have SPM College, Daulat Ram College. So amazing. A lot of colleges, not only from DU, but also from all around the country. The centers and the departments are people from commerce, the languages, the science fields. We have people from political science, physics, mathematics, you name it, we have them. I don't have a problem with sharing the results later with the hosts. The current location, we have people from, again, from all over. So when I asked this question as to what were the, preference of the people, what language and everything, so 57.3%, the majority are okay with both English and Hindi. And 34.4% would prefer only English. And then in Hindi, we have the remaining. Though I must say that my slides are completely in the English language. Wherever there's an issue, I don't have a problem with translating. But it's going to be very simple English language. I don't think there would be any problem. Hopefully not. So now the question which I'd asked all of you is just to kind of know what are the teachers doing? What are the participants among you? What are you using? So I asked this question, which are the online platforms used by you for your online learning and teaching purposes? And you were allowed to choose more than one option. And majority of you actually, which I'm not surprised at all, I have been doing this survey for the past 5-6 presentations of mine, all of them have chosen Zoom as the first option. I think there was one university where the librarians, I was giving them in Punjab University, Chandigarh, and because I don't think they were having that much of an interaction, they had Cisco WebEx as the first preference and Zoom was their second. Otherwise, everywhere it's been the same. We also have people from Microsoft Team, preference, and Google Meet also leads the way with 71 people saying that. Okay, now next I ask the question, do you have knowledge or have used the following for your online learning or teaching purposes? All right, so I asked all of you, have you ever used breakout rooms in Zoom? Okay, so interestingly, if you look at it, the blue line that you see is yes, the red is no, and the orange one is a little bit. And I'm not at all surprised, a lot of people don't know about breakout rooms. So I'm glad I asked this question because and get to know and what should I be telling you about? I don't want to waste your time in repeating something that you already are aware of. Next, I ask everybody, do you know how to raise your hand virtually? Now, few of you, not actually few, many of you might have thought, अरे हमें तो ये आता है, ये मैडम तो इतना सिंपल चीज पूछ रही है. But one number one thing as a teacher you would all know is that never assume that your students know the answer. You always have to imagine that there might be one or two people who don't know. All right, this is the reason why. And as you can see, we do have people who have said no, that they don't know. And somebody has actually, there are people who have said little bit. Okay, and the next one I asked you people, do you know how to mute yourself and unmute yourself? Majority obviously have said yes. Still, we have people who said no. Same thing I asked about the videos. Do you know how to start your video and switch off your video? I asked you people about reactions. Now reactions, remember everybody, it's on the below the right hand corner, wherein you have this word reactions written on it. When you click on it, you get two icons. One is a clapping one, which is known as applauding somebody. And the other one is a thumbs up sign. So generally, you know, sometimes initially when the Zoom classes were going on, the teacher would say, show me a thumbs up sign. And if the teacher didn't say virtual thumbs up sign, everybody would do this. So this was kind of something that, you know, people had to kind of quickly learn and pick up. Next, I asked all of you, how many of you are using Google? This is an extremely important question. I asked you, how many of you are using Google Forms? And surprisingly, we still have a lot of people who are not using Google Forms. If you can see that over here, right? In fact, people are even saying no and little bit. Next, I asked you people, please mention tools that you might be using. So tools are a little bit different from the social platforms, as far as I thought. Okay, so Zoom, I was thinking would more be like an online platform, whereas I wanted answers like, for example, Kahoot is a tool, menti.com is a tool, but it's okay, not a problem. Next, I also asked, so continuing on with this, we also got people who said they use YouTube videos, PowerPoints, Google Classroom seems to be one of your major interests out here. How do you make your online classes effective? So a lot of people said through discussions, via interactive sessions, somebody said polls and live chats, the PPTs. Then I asked you, do you understand the term netiquette? Now, 80.5% people said yes, great, excellent. Still, we have people over here who said no. That's 19.5%. Then I asked you people, do you think we in India need to be made more aware of the core rules of netiquette? And then again, 91.9%, even if you people know that what is netiquette, you still want other people to learn. And I know the reason why. The reason why is because even now, if the video is on, you'll see a few people lying down on their beds. Some of them might even be eating right now. So I actually have pictures which I'm going to share with you in the end. So everybody whose video is on, please be careful. I have requested the host to kindly allow the video to be on and people to be unmuted if they have to interact with me. But with great power comes great responsibility. So it is your responsibility that you don't let me down, all right? Do not switch on your video if you're eating, if you're cooking or doing anything that you're not supposed to be doing. Remember, this is getting recorded. Next, I asked this question, which is pertinent to me. Have you ever attended any session of mine? All right. And 92.6% said no. So I'm glad because I didn't want any repeats for most of you. There are a few. So I'm really wondering who they are. We'll interact later. So I think this was the last question. What is your expectation from this particular session, which is titled Language Empowerment Through Online Teaching? Okay, and a lot of you have given expectations like they want to learn something new, you want to have some hands-on experience, you want to enhance your online communication and interactive skills. All right, so I'm hoping I'm able to justify all the time and effort that you're spending on a Sunday afternoon. And I would like to wish everybody happy International Yoga Day and also happy Father's Day. All right. So the first activity that I wanted to do with everybody, by the way, there are certain activities where I would like you to jot down. Certain activities, I don't want you to do any jotting down. I want you to just listen. So I'll keep telling you what to do when, all right? And there will be an activity where you will be requiring your mobile phone. So please keep that nearby. So here we go. What are the qualities that come to your mind when you want to describe a teacher? Any teacher, yourself, your favorite teacher, the teacher that you don't like maybe, whatever. The personal, social, and professional. So these are generally the good qualities, all right? So they're easily put in one of these brackets, either in a personal bracket, a social bracket, or a professional bracket. And sometimes they even overlap. For example, the qualities might be kind, motivator, leadership, soft-spoken, guide, approachable, friendly, receptive to new ideas, dedicated, cooperative, positive, inspiring others, hardworking, persuasive, ready to learn, affectionate, innovative, helpful, ready to change, ability to empathize, encouraging, ready to experiment, professional, punctual, a role model, a leader, somebody personal, somebody social, a sympathetic person, somebody who's accessible, somebody who's friendly, and last but not the least, somebody who's an effective communicator. All right, I see somebody raising her hand, Dr. Renu Bala. By the way, everybody, if you need to raise your hand, you will only raise it when I actually ask you a particular activity and I want some volunteers, then please raise your hand. Once you raise your hand, then you have to lower your hand also. I hope you know how to lower your hand too. Okay, so I think your hand's already been lowered down by the other host. We'll take your questions later then, all right?
We'll have a quick question answer session after the lecture, Sandesha, Dr. Sandesha.
Yeah. So hopefully people want to raise their hands. I'll request everybody to not raise their hands right now, and unless I ask you for an activity, all right? Okay, so here we go to the next slide. So now everybody, there is something known as the 21st century life skills. I don't know how many of you are aware of it, but just in case you're not, I wanted to point it out. The 21st century life skills, they were created because, as you know, the education methodology, it's going through a change, but maybe not at that kind of a pace, the way the actual world is changing. For example, initially, it was an agrarian kind of work, wherein everything was based on agriculture. Then it went into the industry mode. And now what do you have? You have the world of technology. So we are teaching people, we are teaching students, we are creating the future generation with a particular mindset. But what happens when they go for jobs, the corporate companies or even the government, they don't want, they feel that certain skills are missing. So these are the skills that they were particularly talking about, which educationists then decided to kind of create. So as you can see, these are cognitive skills. You have lateral thinking, critical thinking, problem solving. You have systems thinking, emotional, like empathy, adaptability, self-awareness, resilience. You have creativity, innovation, curiosity, ideation, visualization, leadership, that means organizing, entrepreneurship, excellence, influence without authority. You have collaboration, where you have negotiation skills, conflict management, cross-cultural sensitivity, and communication. Then you have social and civic engagement, wherein you have citizenship, you have environment and sustainability, you have health and wellness, and you have gender harmony and equity. Now, these are 21st century life skills. Why? Because we cannot assume that, you know, homes around the world are actually teaching this to their children. Because how can a parent teach it to a child when the parent himself or herself does not know what this life skill is? Now, I'll come to the part about communication skills. So everybody, when you talk about communication skills, everybody says, okay, yeah, we know what communication skills are. So communication skills comes, the word itself comes from the word communicare. And the communicare word actually means to share. It's a Latin word which means to share. All right. Now, for example, you all know what happens over here. In a communication, you would have a person out here who would be known as a source. You would have a channel. Then you would have the message going through that channel. You would have the receiver. For example, I'm the source. I'm using this particular medium and you are the receivers. And when you will reply back to me and respond to me, that will be my feedback. All right. Now, coming to the skills part, what are these skills? Skills are the ability that, you know, somebody has to do something well. It's an expertise. All right. For example, I've got skills maybe for gardening or for cooking or even the simple one when somebody has a skill to put down the cards to make a kind of like a card house. Now, what is effective communication skills? A lot of people say, hey, what's the difference? Both are the same. They both have communication in them. There is a difference. Okay. So what's the difference? The effectiveness of communication depends upon the extent to which the sender has succeeded in making the receiver understand his idea. All right, feedback, which makes communication two-way, is important because it helps to evaluate the effectiveness of the communication. Now, I'll give you an example of this, which is a very, you know, in cliche. Sorry? Does somebody want to say something? Ritu, Dhanu, I'm muting you. Okay, all right. All right. So, yeah. Mubin ma'am, I'll mute you too, just in case, or you mute yourself accordingly. All right. So now everybody, let me give you an example. So let's say there's a waiter. He comes to take your order. While he's taking your order, he doesn't bring a paper or pen and he says, okay, what's your order? And you say, I want 3 naans. I want 1 paneer masala and I want 1 biryani. All right. And the person comes back after half an hour and he brings 2 naans and he brings paneer bhujia and he brings a pulao. Sorry.
Ma'am, if you want, I can mute all the participants.
Yes,
I think I think it's better if we mute the participants because it's a bit.
I give an access just as you requested, ma'am. But now I think there's a need to.
The thing is that Ravinder ji, you can mute them, and when I require the activity, we'll unmute them then.
Sure.
That can be done. Right.
Yeah. All right. Thank you so much, Ravinder ji. You're the third eye, as I said. So anyway, by the way, let me try this now for everybody. I hope you're getting the gist of everything. And if it's enjoyable, if you're able to understand, now you can give me the thumbs up sign, the virtual one. Look down below. There's a box which says reactions. You can actually click on it and you have a thumbs up sign. Okay. So we'll get to know whether you people are getting the gist of it. All right. So we do see people doing that. Okay. We have people raising their hands too. Okay, all right. So anyway, now what happens when the person comes back later on and the person says that, why did you get the order wrong? Then the waiter says that, oh, this was the order. So now what happens then? The manager cuts his salary and he loses his money, his salary. So he learns the hard way. What did he do wrong? He should have actually taken a paper and pen and he should have confirmed that whatever the customer was asking, he should have repeated the order. Why? Because if you want to effectively communicate, you want the desired result. It's not just coming in as a teacher, coming into a class and just saying whatever you want after 1 hour, leaving and saying, "Acha, maine bol diya whatever I had to say. Maine to padha diya. Bacche samjhe na samjhe, unke upar ki baat hai." That's not the attitude. The attitude should be that you stop, you ask the class that have you understood, and then you go ahead. That is an effective communicator. So now I'm going to ask you people, since we have people raising their hands, Amna Mirza, I'm unmuting you. Okay, I have unmuted you. Now you unmute yourself and speak to me. Yeah, Amna, go ahead. Do you want to say something, Amna?
Yeah. You know, I was just enjoying what you said. Please carry on, Sandesha, ma'am. I like the fact that you're trying to, you know, the entire idea of sending this, you know, form before, you know, this lecture. And most important because, you know, how it's very important that when our entire education paradigm is going on digital way, how you are, you know, asking us to how to make this online communication only very effective. That's why I just raised your hand to just your...
Right. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Please unmute me, ma'am.
Okay, I muted you and lowering your hand also. Okay, so now everybody... It was good to get that kind of a feedback. Thank you so much. All right. So as Amna ma'am rightly said, and she has also pointed out, your maybe even your opinion might be the same. We all know the situation that we are in. None of us were prepared for it. No one, at least not in our country. And with the immediate lockdown, we all had to adapt. I actually thank the teachers, the school teachers of my two daughters for actually making me realize that it is possible. Because after 1 week, I was in a state of shock, maybe, like, how do I reach out? And then in the second week, when the teachers started reaching out to my daughters, and then I learned from them, and I started my classes on the third week. So this goes to show that we can learn a lot from each other. Right now, I'm not here to teach you. I'm here to share whatever little knowledge that I have gained in the last 2.5 months via this online mode of, you know, teaching and learning process. And hopefully towards the end, I'll also learn from you. There's another very important thing which I just got reminded. A lot of people, there are a lot of experts who actually say that what we're doing right now, this isn't online teaching. Sorry, what you're doing on Zoom, this is not online teaching. What you should be doing is the MOOC programs, the modules, the Swayam programs, those are the kind of online effective methods. I, to a certain extent, do agree with them because there's a lot of energy, a lot of dedication, a lot of time and effort that is taken to prepare such MOOC modules. I'm sure most of you might have even attended those kind of online workshops and FTP programs. You're learning how to create them. You know how much of your effort is required from you. But unfortunately, we didn't have that kind of a time. So we had to quickly adapt to the situation. On a personal level, I even spoke to somebody, one of my colleagues yesterday, Dr. Sonu Saini, and he actually told me, in a way, they are right. That might be the passive way, but maybe the active way is this kind of an interaction that we're having right now. So we actually need both of them maybe. And then also the fact that you all must have been hearing these two words, synchronous and asynchronous. And you might have also heard a third word, which is blended mode of learning. Sounds reminds you of a blender, right? Where everything is getting blended, one big khichdi. Yeah, that's exactly what is happening. On a personal note, I personally feel as a teacher, it's my job to get my students to, you know, understand whatever it is that I want to tell them or whatever I want to share with them, whether I do it through WhatsApp groups, whether I do it by calling them, whether I get an email, whether I get Google Classroom, a MOOC module program, or even Zoom interactive sessions. All right. So whatever is your choice, it's your choice. Now, let's quickly go to the next part. So effective communication is a dynamic process. It cannot be static, right? And through this process, we convey a thought or feeling to someone else. How it is received depends on a set of events, stimuli that a person is exposed to. So that means, for example, let me say about something that I experienced in Hong Kong. But if suppose the other person who's listening is not familiar with the culture or the language or anything to do with Hong Kong, it might take a little bit more time. So everything depends on a lot of things. How you say, what you say plays an important role in effective communication. Come on, everybody, repeat after me. I know you had a fabulous lunch because today was Father's Day, but repeat after me. How you say, what you say plays an important role in effective communication, all right? Now, let's come to the part, language skills. Now, there are so many language teachers here right now. Everybody knows this, but I'm going to talk for this for everybody. You all know that we have inputs and outputs happening, all right? So listening, speaking, reading, and writing. Out of these, which are the two which are inputs? It has to be listening, it has to be reading, all right? Speaking and writing. These are outputs. You cannot get an output till you don't get an input. This is the reason why every time after I've had my first class, some kid from some area will come and say, Madam, main kab achhi tarah angrezi mein baat kar paunga. Then the next question I ask that student is that, do you listen to anything in English? He says, no. I said, do you read anything in English? This is no. Then I said, if you don't have any input, how are you expecting to start speaking and writing better? You need to keep doing it. The more you practice, the better you get. Everybody remember, when a baby is born, the baby doesn't start speaking just immediately. The baby does an entire process. The baby is learning, listening, learning, and obviously saying words out. And whenever the child makes a mistake, we correct the child. Why is it that when we grow up, we get scared, we lose our confidence, so we stop speaking because we don't want people to laugh at us. Don't worry about that. The people who learn the fastest are the ones who don't care about the world. Okay. Now, communication skills. You have oral, written, and nonverbal. In oral, you have presentations, you have audience awareness, you have critical listening, you have body language. In written, you have academic writing, you have revision and editing, you have critical reading, you have presentation of data. Nonverbal, again, you have audience awareness, but personal presentation and body language. Now, this comes to the interesting part out here, which is the total communication process. Do you know in our country, what do we focus on? We tend to focus on the reading, writing, speaking. How many of us focus on the listening part? This is the reason why we're not listening to each other. All right. Listening is actually 45%. All right. Whereas reading is 16, writing is 9, and speaking is 30. So I think it's high time we started paying a little bit of importance out here. Now, effective communication requires 7% words. Words are only labels, and listeners, they put their own interpretations on the speaker's words, all right? 38% is paralinguistic. The way in which something is said, the accent, the tone, the voice modulation, everything is important to the listener. For example, let me tell you one thing. All of you are part of WhatsApp groups, right? How many WhatsApp groups have you seen where people start fighting each other? And why? Because somebody says one thing and the other person interprets it the way he or she wants it to. Okay, why? Because WhatsApp, you can't hear the person. So this is the reason why I've started recording my voice so that people understand exactly what I want to say. For example, suppose I type something like, oh, you've come. Okay. Now, my oh, you come, which I've typed, could be, oh, you've come. Oh, you've come. Oh, you've come. So can you see that? When I speak out, you come to know what is my emotion behind that three words, oh, you've come. All right. 55% is body language. What a speaker looks like while delivering a message affects the listener's understanding the most, because you can kind of see the expressions. You can see the body language. Are they more forthcoming towards you, or are they just relaxed and they don't have a care? All right. Like, for example, if I'm speaking to you like this and I'm like, yeah, like this and like that, and I'm not having a kind of eye contact with you, and I'm thinking that it doesn't matter because you're hearing my voice. Do you think that is going to be effective? I don't think so. All right. Now, everybody, I want to tell you a little bit, quick little story. All right. There was a man. All right. He went to the sea and he went to catch a fish. All right. But what happened? He waited for 1 hour and he couldn't get any fish. Later on, he saw that one of his neighbors went there and within half an hour got at least one bucket full of fishes. And he was wondering how come that was possible. That was because the neighbor knew where to fish, under which particular place. Maybe, you know, the fishes needed a quiet place. The neighbor knew which bait to use. All these things matter. That means to catch a fish, think like the fish. So if you want to actually be an effective presenter, who are you presenting for? Are you presenting for yourself? No, you're presenting for the audience. Think about the audience needs. Just now, Abna ma'am said that I like the way that you said the Google form. You know why I sent the Google form? Because I wanted to know your needs. This is the reason why. What I'm presenting to you right now, tomorrow you people are going to be presenting not only in your classes. I'm expecting you people to be going for online conferences, because now conferences are going to be like this. I have been attending conferences in Russia, in Australia, just like this. In Thailand also, just like this. So we all have to be prepared to present to the world now. Now, culture is like an iceberg, wherein you have visible behaviors and then you have invisible sources, where you have values, you have beliefs and assumptions. So this is an iceberg concept or culture, which basically says that you can see a person's dress, you can see a person's age, gender, language, race or ethnicity, the physical characteristics, but the actual behavior, the facial expressions, the body language, the gender identity. That means a person could look like a man, but inside he might be more feminine than masculine. Notions of modesty, the concept of cleanliness, emotional response, patterns, rules for social interaction, and concept of justice, and many more things out here. Mental health, okay? Patterns of superior and subordinate roles in relation to status by age, gender, and class. All these things are not above. They are below. They are things which you cannot see till you don't get to know the person a bit more. I'm just having a look at the time. It's already half an hour, so I'm going to quickly go. The external barriers in communication could be environment, the venue, the effect of noise, temperature in the room, other people around you, the status, the education, whatnot. Time. Right now, time is going to be a barrier for me. I'm not going to go through the 7 C's of effective communication because most of you would already be aware of it. I just wanted to point out, I'm going to give you a thali and you can pick and choose whatever you want. All right. Let me come to the 4 basic styles of communicators. You have passive communicators, you have aggressive communicators, you have passive aggressive communicators, and you have assertive ones. So the passive ones are individuals who use the passive communication style and they often act indifferently. They're yielding to others. Passive communicators usually fail to express their feelings or needs. They allow others to express themselves. The aggressive ones, it's often apparent when someone communicates in an aggressive manner. You will hear them, you know, you'll hear them shouting. You'll see shouting, they'll be like this. You may even feel that aggression. Passive aggressive, it's a combination where you have passive aggressive communication style users. They appear to be passive on the surface, but within it, below the surface, they are powerless or they are stuck. They're building up a resentment that leads to some kind of acting out in a subtle, indirect or secret way. And the assertive people, they are thought to be the most effective form of communicators. The assertive communication style features an open communication link, which is not too overbearing. And assertive communicators, they can express their own needs, their desires, their ideas and their feelings, while also considering the need of others. Assertive communicators, they aim for both sides to win in a situation, balancing one's right with the right of the other person. So if you look at these four kind of communicators, I think you can gauge which one you are in, which category. Maybe you can even think in which category your spouse is in or whoever it is. Okay, attention, everybody. All right, here we go. There is an activity coming up. So everybody, pay attention. Sorry, somebody speaking. Okay. Afzal Fatima ji. Okay, you've been muted. Thank you, Ravindra ji, or whoever muted her. Okay, so attention, everybody. Here we start with the activity. Now, I'm going to say 15 words. Don't write it down. Don't record it anywhere. Just listen to it carefully and try to memorize it. Okay? So the words are, ready? Dream, sleep, night, mattress, snooze, sheet, nod, tired, artichoke, blanket, alarm, nap, snore, pillow. All right, I said 15 words. Let's see how many of you listen to it. Now, five basic reasons for not listening. Listening is hard work, competition, the rush for action. Like, you know, you don't want to listen because, you know, you just want to like, oh, okay, I understand what you're saying. And you want to respond back. So you're not listening till the end. Speed difference, like 120 word per minute versus 360 words per minute. All right. So this is one interesting thing I must tell you for the English language teachers. Most of us, if you know, when we speak in English, we bring the influence of our Indian languages, because when we are speaking in Hindi, we speak more words per minute in Hindi. So when we talk in English, we tend to talk in English also pretty fast. Whereas if you look at the native speakers, they might not end up saying that many words per minute. All right. Lack of training. Yeah. As you know, with the, you know, our so entire educational skills, not having any syllabus with so much to do with listening skills, what can you expect? The four levels of listening, the non-listeners, they don't listen at all because they're genuinely disinterested in the subject. They don't care. These people, they'll pretend. Like right now, there are approximately 238 people here. I don't know, maybe few of you might not be listening right now. These people, they'll pretend to follow the speaker while they're actually, they're preoccupied with something else. The marginal listeners, these are the people who are impatient to listen to the main idea. The marginal listeners, they pay superficial attention. That means they just listen. In Hindi, they say upar ki baat sunna. They are not interested in the bottom line. They're interested only in the bottom line. They merely hear the sound of the words, but they fail to grasp their meanings. They do not go to the deeper level of arguments. The evaluative listeners, these are the ones who are literally, they're assessing the verbal content on the basis of words and not paralinguistic or non-verbal cues. Generally, they will use logic to understand the content. Hence, they will distance themselves emotionally from the subject. As a result, they do not show empathy or sensitivity to the speaker. Okay, these are the evaluative listeners. The active listeners. The active listener is somebody who is serious about the whole process of communication. She or he will pay attention. Sorry, one second. She or he will pay attention to the speaker's stance. Stance means the way that you're standing or sitting or whatever. Your perspective, the point of view and the biases and the prejudices. Okay, all the underlining. Okay, one interesting thing which I wanted to tell you earlier. How many of you know what is the meaning of paralinguistic? Linguistic, you must have guessed, to do with languages, all right? Para, the word para means support. For example, paramilitary forces, that means the supporting force to the military. Okay, same way you have paramedical forces, paramedical doctors or whatever, assistants, health workers. All right, so let's go to the next one. Improving effective listening skills. How do I improve my effective, you know, how do I improve myself into becoming a better listener? By not being preoccupied, by being open-minded and non-defensive, like give the other person a chance. Let him or her say whatever they want to say. We are in a democracy, everybody. We have the thing to actually listen to people. Minimizing interruptions. Like, don't interrupt people. Don't type things in the chat box. Wait, let them, you know, ask you in the end. Effective listening hearing, it's interpreting when necessary, and understanding the message and then relating to it. Everybody, repeat after me. Effective listening is hearing, interpreting when necessary, understanding the message and relating to it. And then by asking questions. That means I heard something, but if I want to confirm that what I heard, is this what the person meant? That is when I will ask the question in the end. The levels of communication, you have a verbal one, like an intraverbal, you have intonation of word and sound. You have an extraverbal, that is implication of words and phrases, the semantics. And you have nonverbal, that is gestures and postures and movements. Gestures are like, for example, my hand gestures. Postures are, for example, I'm seated. I could be standing and giving the same session. Movements, you know, if I was moving around in a classroom. And symbolic ones are different. They're like to do with images and all. Now, types of body language. Remember that you're dealing with people. People is the acronym for postures and gestures. P for postures and gestures. How do you use your hand gesture? Eye contact, that how's your lighthouse? That means when you're looking, you're not like right now, I'm all looking at you guys straight. But if I was in a classroom, I wouldn't be just looking it straight, right? I'd be like, you know how a lighthouse is, right? A lighthouse goes like this. So I'd be looking to the left. I'd be looking to the straight and right. I'll be looking in front. I'll be going in the back. So that's the way to go about it. Orientation, how do you position yourself, right? Presentation, how do you deliver your message? Sorry. Are you able to see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, Sandesha. Yes, we can see.
Okay, all right. Sorry. Okay, looks. Are your looks or appearance, is a dress important? Who am I dressing up for right now? I'm dressing up not just for myself. I'm dressing up for the audience, because the audience should feel like, you know, when they feel that you have a pleasing personality, then even their senses will open up to you. And I'm not just talking about, you know, sometimes you need to have a little bit of incense sticks, a good smell around you, because it opens up. It's actually scientifically proven. Expressions of emotion. Are you using facial expressions to express your emotion? Like if you're happy, are you looking like you're happy? Or are you looking like, yeah, very good for you? I mean, what? You should look like you're, yeah, very good for you, you know? Okay, now, all right, everybody, I need 4 volunteers. The first 4 to raise their hands, they get to be my volunteers. So here we go. Sir? My third eye? Panji,
yes, awesome.
Okay, great. Khushbu Singla raised her hand. Okay. I saw her name first. And then, who are the other hands? Can you see the hands, the 4 hands? Don't lower their hands, please. I won't be able to see. Kamlesh.
Right now.
Okay. Khushbu, Kamlesh, 2 more hands we need. Come on, people. If you're there. Okay. How come I'm seeing Rimpi? All right. So now there are 4 people. Okay, now I'm saying who the people are. Khushbu Singla, Kamlesh, Dr. Rochit Kumar Rai, and Kavita Bangwara. Bangarva. I'm so sorry. Please excuse me. So these 4 people, you are my 4 volunteers, all right? One by one, you will be taking up a role, okay? You will be saying a message. For example, Khushbu Singla will take up the first role. She will be the MD. Kamlesh will be the director. Kavita Bangarwa will be the manager, I think, and the 4th person will be the section head. All right, so here we go. Khushbu Singla, I'm unmuting you. Are you there? Khushbu, unmute yourself, please.
Yeah. Hello, good afternoon, ma'am. Yes, I'm there.
Good afternoon, Khushbu. Oh, you're a mother. The young
yeah.
Baby. Oh, I'm so sorry. Will the baby be able to keep quiet for a few minutes?
Yeah, ma'am, please.
Okay. All right. Do you want to take some time to look after this? I'll give you a chance again. Don't worry. I'll mute you now. I'll give you a chance. Don't worry. Okay. All right. So Khushbu, till the time she doesn't sort out the thing at home, let's go to Kamlesh. Kamlesh, I'm unmuting you.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Kamlesh. Where are you?
Hi, ma'am.
Where are you? Where are you located? Where are you joining us from? What do you do? Tell us something.
Ma'am, I'm located in Delhi Southwest area in a village.
Okay, wow. What do you do? Are you teaching?
I'm teaching. I'm a teacher.
Okay, very good. Excellent. So now you are the MD, okay? Now you have to read, you will read what you see on the screen, okay?
Okay, ma'am. Communication distortion.
Okay, no, you will read the message starting from you, okay? The managing director calls the director. So you are the managing director. So read the line over here. You may be aware. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. You may be aware that there will be a solar eclipse tomorrow. This unique phenomena occurs only once in 50 years. If you are lucky, you can witness the incident only once in your lifetime. I would like to take this opportunity to meet the workmen and explain to them the principle behind this phenomena. Kindly inform them and request them to assemble outside the canteen dressed in their best clothes at 9 a.m. tomorrow.
Okay, excellent. Thank you so much, dear.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, next we are going to go to Kavita. Kavita, please unmute yourself. And Khushbu can mute us. I think, was it?
Hello, ma'am. I've unmuted myself.
Okay, Kavita, excellent. Where are you? Where are you joining us from?
I'm joining from Jaipur.
Oh, wow. Okay, so are you teaching?
Yes, ma'am.
How is the session till now? Are you able to get everything, whatever I've been saying? Are you bored? Are you sleepy?
Yes, I was able to. No, I was not feeling sleepy. I was feeling good. More interactive.
Okay, very good. So now, Kavita, you are Director Kavita, okay? So now you heard the message from your MD, and now you're going to pass on the same message to your manager. Now read the message that you see.
Tomorrow there will be a total eclipse. Sun will disappear at 9 a.m. MD wants all the workers to assemble outside the canteen in their best clothes. MD will explain them the principle behind the incident. This is a unique opportunity you won't get again in your lifetime.
Okay, excellent. Thank you so much, Director Kavita. Now we'll go to Khushbu. Khushbu, I hope things are sorted out for you. Khushbu?
Yes, ma'am.
Excellent.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, Khushbu, you are the manager, my dear. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Oh, by the way, Khushbu, where are you joining us from?
Ma'am, I'm from Haryana, Kethal, near by Kurukshetra.
Yes, yes. A lot of people are very active nowadays on online. I see a lot of them. All right. So, here we go. Read this out, my dear. You are the manager.
Manager. Okay, ma'am. Sun will disappear at 9 a.m. MD in his best clothes will meet the workmen inside the canteen. Director will explain the principle. This is a unique opportunity you won't get again in your lifetime.
Okay, thank you so much, Khushbu. Okay, we thank have you, one more spot. One more person who raises his or her hand will get the opportunity to be the fourth person. Who's there? Oh, Priyam Ghosh, I just saw. So, Priyam Ghosh, I'm unmuting you.
Hi, ma'am.
Hi, good afternoon. Where are you joining us from, Priya?
I'm joining from Delhi, and let me just quickly take an opportunity to thank you because I'm an ex-JNU student and have had attended linguistic empowerment cell meetings. So thank you so much for that.
Okay. Thank you so much, dear. Thank you. Are you teaching now?
Yes, I am.
Okay, excellent. Where are you teaching?
I'm teaching in one of an affiliated colleges with Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University. I teach mass communication to undergraduate students.
Excellent, excellent. You're the perfect person to do this now. So now you are the section head. So kindly just take over and just read this out to your workmen.
Dear workmen, our managing director will disappear in his best clothes at 9 a.m. tomorrow. This is a unique opportunity to witness. You won't get this opportunity again in your lifetime. The director will meet you all at the canteen to explain the principle of disappearance of our managing director.
Okay, all right. Thank you so much, Priyam. Priyam, hold on. Don't mute yourself. Quickly, I'll ask you the question because we don't have much time. So I'm going to ask this question to everybody, but because you're on board right now, you can. What did you learn from this entire episode? The next question is also there. At what stage and why do you think the message got distorted? And the last question, how would you have stopped this from happening, this distortion? So,
Ma'am, I think this sort of remains a case of what we would call the Chinese whisper, which the message, once it's communicated from one person to another, sort of gets, mixed up, or one or two words just get mixed up. And that's what has happened in this case. I think between the second and third stage is when the mix-up happens between, concerning with the idea of solar eclipse, it sort of, disappears, and it becomes more of a case of disappearance of the managing director.
How would you have stopped it? That's the question, the big question. How would you have stopped it?
I think I would have either, if it was me, I would have put up a notice instead of making an announcement.
Even even before you took the note, even if you made a notice, what would you have done?
Make a notice, send emails, and maybe address the workers directly.
Even before you make the notice, that's what I'm trying to ask you. Making a notice means you're writing it. What would you have done before writing it? You would have cross-checked. Yes, you would have listened, and you would have asked him or her that, excuse me, can I note it down, whatever you're saying? Because we all have memory only till a certain capacity. There is no sure shot that whatever I'm saying right now, if you people are not noting it, it's going to be very difficult for all of you to remember everything that I've said, right?
Yes,
ma'am. And it has to be jotted down somewhere. It has to be taken into points. So those are important. So that's what I meant. Thank you so much, Priyam. Thank you. And all the best to all of you. Okay. So I'm going to meet you again and quickly, because we don't have much time. To avoid communication distortions, what should you be doing? Remember, people always tend to hear only what they want to hear. Everybody, jor se bolo. Just repeat after me. People always tend to hear only what they want to hear. All the wives in this particular group, you all know what I'm talking about. Our husbands never, ever, they will hear what they want to hear. Okay, I'm just joking. I'm just kidding. It could be vice versa. The husbands will be saying, main bhi yahi to bol raha hun. To ensure that they are listening, one must make sure to grab their attention at the beginning and also in the middle of one's conversation. You as a teacher, you as a presenter, can't expect that, oh, starting mein sab sun rahe the, to end tak sab sunte rahenge. No, people might go to sleep. You have to wake them up. You have to check, are they, awake or not? Okay, so quickly, now everybody quickly, there's a very quick action activity that's going to happen. It's going to happen on menti.com. Please get your mobiles. If not your mobile and you're on a laptop, please open another browser and type menti, menti.com. Everybody type menti.com. And Panji will put down the code over there. I will give you the code. When you type menti.com, you will see this place where it will ask you to put in a code. Okay? You have to type the code 757091. I repeat, the code is 757091. Come on, guys. I think you deserve a break. All right? Everybody got it? This is what you will see. And by the way, welcome to Atma Ram Sanatan Dharma College. All right? So now quickly, I need to go to that particular thing. So So everybody, I hope you're ready, because now I'm about to start the quiz. I'd like to know how many of you have joined. Okay, there seems to be a little bit of a, okay. All right, everybody, I can already see people on the right hand side. You can see the heart, and everybody is like, it's going dhak dhak. That means the heart is going around. So I'm going to kind of just close my video for a sec so that you people can go ahead. Okay. Okay, Mubin ma'am, we can see you. Nice. So I hope you're also ready to play. All right, a lot of people are joining in. So here we go. Now, everybody, It will ask you to put in your initials or your name. Don't put initials, put down your first name because somebody else might have the same initials. Okay, so if your name is, for example, Sandesha Raipa, then put down Sandesha, don't put SR. All right, everybody, we're getting late, so I'm about to start the quiz. I'm so sorry if you haven't been able to join, but here we go. And by the way, fastest fingers first. It's not just answering correctly, it's also about answering it fast. So let's see how many of you are not cooking or sleeping or eating. So the first one, which one is not one of the seven C's of effective communication? Okay, which one is not? Concreteness, clarity, conversant, conciseness. Okay, which one is not the seven C's? 3, 2, 1, tear, time's up. All right, everybody, very good. 30 of you got it correct. But we still have a lot of people who got it wrong. But the person to get it correct, let's see who got it correct the fastest. Oh, okay. We have, here we go. The fastest person who we have is Shri. Okay. But Kinjak Sharma is the fastest. I'm so sorry. Yeah. All right. So next question. Which one is not an example of a netiquette? All right. Respecting one's privacy by not sharing their personal information, don't swear or use offensive language, or replying to negative comments with more negative comments. 3, 2, 1. Teh. 42 of you got it correct, but we still have a lot of people who got it wrong. We have around, I think, 22 people who got it wrong. Not a problem. Hopefully you learn it after this. And again, the fastest person, I believe, is fastest person is Binu. All right. Very good, Binu. Which one of the following words was among the 15 words I had dictated earlier? Remember, I told you people to pay attention. Was it day, bed, moon, night, or cushion? Okay. Which word was among the 15 words? 3, 2, 1, te. All right, let's see now who got it. 27 of you got it correct, by the way. But let's see who got it fastest. Night was the correct answer, yes. Okay, Kinjak Sharma, you were the fastest, but Michelle is really leading the way. Because remember, your points get collected from the previous one. So if you get even one answer wrong, you lose down. Which one is the characteristic of the passive communication style? Is it intolerant, agreeable, offensive, or egotistical? All right. So which one is the one which is the passive communicator? 3, 2, 1. Okay. All right. So agreeable, 26 of you got it correct, but a lot of you got this wrong. All right. And the fastest person over here, we have... All right, Binu, you're leading. Okay, but the fastest person was Rupali, by the way, but Binu got first because obviously Binu has scored a lot of points earlier. Okay, now which one is not a characteristic of the aggressive communication style? Okay, is it avoiding direct communication, loud voice, interrupts, or poor listener? Which one is not? Remember, not. 3, 2, 1. Okay. The avoiding direct communication was the correct answer. Oh, okay. Why did you guys choose poor listener? I don't know. See, you guys got it wrong. Okay, so let's see who won. And the trophy goes to tan 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 tan. Okay, here we go. And the trophy goes to Ronald. Oh my god. Ye peeche se aake first aane wala person is Ronald. All right, not bad. All right, I applaud you, Ronald. One second, let us try finding Ronald. Ronald, okay, hold on, not now. We'll talk to you later, Ronald. There are two more questions remaining, everybody. Quickly. What are the qualities that you think you possess as a teacher? Each one of you can type two different words, one word, like two words, all right? What do you think as a teacher, what would you like to be called? Type those two words and submit it. You have two chances to submit one word answers, basically. And the word cloud will come up over here. Come on, everybody. Very good. Friendly, interactive, positive attitude, enthusiastic, inspiring, good listener, respectable, effective communicator, confidence, analytical, okay, dedicated, smiling face. I don't know if you're talking about, you are talking about yourself, everybody. Yes, you guys are amazing. See, Mubin ma'am, you got some amazing participants today. I knew it that they were amazing. The minute I saw your Google form answers, I knew you guys are communicators. Okay, Garima Arora is raising a hand. Garima, please hold on. I'll just interact with you after this. All right, guys, quickly, let's go to the next one. I asked this question. Did you know the difference between communication skills and effective communication skills before this session? Thank you, everybody, for your honesty. Majority of you knew the answer. That's good for you. A few of you didn't. Like, there's a no, there's a little bit. So that I hope I reached out to those people. Okay, thank you so much. Oh, by the way, the no's are increasing now. Okay, some honesty is coming forth. All right, everybody. By the way, you can ask me anything. You can ask me a question and it'll pop up over here. Just by the way, I'm doing this so that you people can learn how to make it an interactive session. How can you make a session more interactive by using menti.com? You having the knowledge of the tool is not enough. Having the knowledge of the content is not enough. You should know how to use the tool also. Okay. Maybe you people need time to type the questions.
Sandesha ma'am, we'll be taking question answer session after lecture, or is this part of the activity?
Yeah, this was the part of the activity.
Okay.
So now, so everybody, thank you so much. I can see you people clicking on the heart sign out here. Thank you so much, everybody. I just wanted to show you the ways by which you could actually, go about with making your sessions more interactive, because this is one of the things that that is always asked by people. And I think the earlier speaker also did an excellent job of telling all of you. So now let me quickly come towards the end. Speaking skills, how do you develop on that? Body language is a combination of eye contact, tone, gestures, and posture. Learning to control your body language exuberates confidence even when one is feeling nervous. For example, I'm super nervous. With every session, I'm super nervous, but I kind of get my energy from the people around me. So audience listens attentively to those who they feel. One second. Are you able to see my screen? I think not. Hold on.
Yeah, please switch on your video, Sandesha ji.
Yeah,
please. Thank you. Yeah, we can see you now.
Yeah. So audience listens attentively to those who they feel are confident in their talk. So if you exuberate confidence, then the people around you will also reciprocate to that kind of a confidence. It's an infectious thing, like a smile. So now everybody repeat after me. IC, TP, GP. Okay, repeat after me. IC, TP, GP. This should be your mantra. IC means eye contact. Remember to have an eye contact. There are people who actually are so nervous, they can't look at people when they're talking to them. They'll be looking like this or looking like this. You should be always looking at the people in front of you. Keep your audience members engaged. Your tone and your pace, it should reflect enthusiasm and energy. You should sound like you really want to be here. Like, I really want to be here for all of you. Your conversational tone, it should not be a monotone. It should be like having its ups and downs. If I talk like this, then you all will be sleeping in the next 2-3 minutes, right? That's the whole point. When you go up and down, then people come to know where the emphasis has to be laid. Speak loud and clear. Speak at a reasonable pace. I also need to lower my pace because I speak a little bit fast, but definitely a reasonable pace is required. Gestures and postures. You have to balance between good posture and not looking stiff. You have to use your hands to emphasize the points wherever it is necessary. You don't keep shaking your hands like this. You have to use it appropriately, balanced manner. Okay. Now, quickly, what are the things that I did? As a, I teach basically a basic communication skills, English for academic writing. I had a LEC online class debate competition. Remember I told you about 21st century life skills? You can actually get your students to prepare the poster. you can get them involved, make them start feeling from the start that, yes, I am doing something for the class. And this is the kind of thing that I was talking about. You must be having more students. Now, everybody look at this particular picture. Can you see on the bottom where I'm pointing with the arrow, there is a word that says breakout rooms. Now, let me tell you the thing about breakout rooms. Breakout rooms is only possible before you start the session, not afterwards. For example, if I'm looking right now, over here, we don't have the possibility of a breakout room because it has not been clicked. Okay, so this has to be done. All right, next. There is a YouTube link, which is of a person who is a Russian language teacher. His student, actually, what he did was, he recorded everything during the lockdown. He not only taught his father, mother, sister, and dadi Russian language, he even taught his neighbor the Russian language through the terrace. So obviously, right now, we don't have that much time. I'll share the link. You all can see for yourself that it is doable. Okay? So what this boy is doing is, he's taking people around his house, and he's showing that this is this, and he's saying everything in Russian. Okay? As he goes around the house, I'm so proud of his mother, by the way. Look at that. She's learning Russian. Okay? And after that, he went to his father. Then he went to his sister. And his sister also spoke in Russian. His sister has never learned Russian in her life. She just spoke right here. Okay. Okay. The thing is that because these videos, you know, hold on. Give me a second. Let me just open up my... You know, there's a saying, bade bade sheharon mein aisi choti choti baatein hoti rehti hain. So always remember, aise bade bade sessions mein aisi choti choti baatein bhi hoti rehti hain. Okay? So anyway, so here we are, and I'm about to share the screen. I've got it. I've got the thing happening out here. Don't panic, everybody. Whenever something like this happens, it doesn't help in panicking. Just go ahead with the flow. It'll all work out for all of you. Okay. So anyway, now this was one of my students. She actually spoke about.
And I'm going to speak negative impacts of lockdown on children. So first, I'll start with some.
So I just wanted to show you that there are students who might not be able to come for that particular Zoom session, not a problem. What they do is they send a recording through the WhatsApp. That's not an issue. Then we also have PPTs.
Bonjour à tous et à toutes. Je m'appelle Sulena. Je suis en train de faire mon doctorat. Où le virus est en train.
So the interesting thing was this girl, Sunaina, she is currently doing her PhD in the French language. And she actually presented this in an online for an international online conference in Paris. And if you can see the background, the virtual background, she did not know how to create a virtual background. So when she asked me, ma'am, how do you do it? Then I told her about it. All of you who try virtual background, if your laptop is not compatible, I will give you a little tip. The tip is use a green tie, green patta, hang it behind you, and you will get your virtual background. This girl is doing the same thing, by the way. Okay. All right. Now, reading and writing skills, there was a particular form. Anji, can you please put that form over there?
Sure.
Yeah. Everybody, there's a Google form link. We don't have much time, maybe 5 minutes and I have to end the session. But if you just click on, yes, ma'am. So if you click.
We have a lot of questions coming.
Okay. Sure. Just give me a second, ma'am. If you click on the Google form link, this is based on something which I was doing. All of you who are school teachers, you might know this. The NCERT CPC have decided to do art integrated learning. Art integrated learning, not only in the languages, but also in maths, in science, in all the subjects. So it's a beautiful thing. So I was invited to be a speaker, And this particular session, this part is from that particular session, the Google form. Click on it. You can see there are 2-3 images. There's a very famous image. The Sistine Chapel has this image of the creation of Adam. All right. There are 2 different spoofs of that particular image. And you can write about it. Same way, you can, instead of putting the image to write about, you can put a paragraph and ask people to read it and to, you know, answer certain questions. It could be objective, it could be subjective. And if you have like 2-3 pages, ask them to email them to you. All right. Lot of people have this question that, ma'am, how do we know if people are not copying this? See, there is a timestamp which comes. So you kind of know, you know, what people are doing. But at the end of the day, I think right now the situation is that the students themselves should know that copying is not going to help them. As a teacher, when we are reading, we know who's copying and who's not. So now coming to the quick part about netiquette. So what are netiquettes? You all know netiquettes are network etiquettes, which are concerned with the proper way to communicate in an online environment. Platforms would include anything like email, social media, online chat, web forums, website comments, multiplayer gaming, other types of online communication. Now, this particular thing, I'm not going to go through it. You can easily find it on the net. Virginia Shee, she is the person in the 1990s. She wrote the core rules of netiquette in her book. Okay, you'll get it on the internet, Google Baba. He will tell you everything. And why do you need to know these netiquettes during COVID-19? Because as teachers, we have to reach out to our students. We have to understand their technical needs. All our students are not able to, you know, they don't have laptops. I'm from JNU. In JNU, I have students who don't even have a smartphone. Forget about a laptop. And I can't blame them if they don't have it. Adapt your teaching methodology to the available tools. At the same time, out of 50 students, if 20 students don't have it, then what do? You stop teaching. At least reach out to the 30. The remaining 20, you reach out to them later or separately. Check your sources. Respect your students' opinions. Give students a fair time to answer. You have to give and you have to take breaks. Like the the host of this particular session, they're doing a wonderful thing of that 5 minutes break, the 1 hour lunch break, excellent. You have to set few ground rules. Everybody, when you have a profile name, please make sure that you use your own name. Please don't put pictures of animals or anything like that. Don't put your children's photograph. Put a decent photograph of yourself because the world is looking at that photograph. Always when you enter into a conference, mute yourselves. Unmute yourself only when you're allowed to. Don't talk out of turns. Okay, I'm sorry. This got repeated again. And we are towards the end. Now, I don't know why this is, I'm so sorry. Okay, so this was in May, I had done the same session. And this is now June. And till now, I'm still finding people who don't know what netiquette is all about. Now, look at this picture. There, I'm trying to hide the identity of the person. So I'm sure you people won't know who he or she is. This person was lying down. Not only lying down, this person slept. And this is, thank God, not my session. It was somebody else's session. And half the time, we're seeing people's fans. I kind of have a very good idea what kind of fans are the best fans in our country now. There are people who are eating, which is very common. And then there was a lady, she was not only cooking rotis, her husband came and actually made more, he needed the dough. And even the son came in. Not only that, they showed the entire picture of their kitchen. And it was not like by mistake. They knew it was happening. Like she was pointing to it and she was telling this. Why am I putting these pictures? I'm not putting these pictures to make fun of these people, these humble people. I'm making all of you aware of what is going on. You have to be very careful. Remember this picture I told you about, right? The 21st century life skills. Okay, so I created a particular page, a Facebook page. I called it Constructive Communicare. I'm sure now you know why I called it. And guess who created the logo? I'm proud to say this. This logo was created by my 13-year-old. So this is what? If your children, your students, they are the next generation, and if they're able to understand the concept and they're able to come out with something, you know, it's amazing. That's when you feel like, wow. All right. There is one more quick link, everybody. You can give me your questions there while ma'am is also taking it, because then I can see those questions. Because what happens, this is a very good way, by the way, to get a quick feedback and a quick Q&A when you are the presenter. Because what happens in the chat box, everybody starts saying, oh, very good. Good presentation. Thank you. Then you miss out on the important questions. So this is the way. And the 17 words were this. All right. Thank you so much, everybody, for your time and effort. And my third eye, Panji, thank you so much. I hope you put the final link also. So let me see if people have actually, I can see whether the questions are there. Yes, Mubin ma'am, aap taali maar rahe ho, I can see
that. Yeah, learned so much from you, Sandesha. Yes, an excellent session. And I think you can read the feedback that you're getting in the chat box.
No, I'm not looking there, actually. I'm honestly not looking at the chat box right now.
Yeah, I'll just take some very quick questions. A lot of questions coming. There is this one very interesting question from Dr. Ganga Das Singh. He's asking, how is the online system a better medium of effective communication than face-to-face communication?
I'm sorry, Dr. Ganga Das, where are you? First of all, let me speak to Dr. Ganga Das. Ganga Das ji, I'm unmuting you. Can you please, you can start your video and you can unmute yourself.
Sandesha ji, can we take the questions?
Oh, okay. All right.
Sorry. Because we have another session after this.
Okay. So quickly, let me just tell you, I never, ever, ever, ever said that being an online communicator means that you're a better communicator vis-a-vis, you know, actually meeting people or teaching students in a classroom. Look at my classroom right now. It's empty. Do you think I'm happy about it? I'm not. All right. No teacher would be happy about not being able to meet his or her students. This is an adapting kind of mode. This is an emergency kind of mode. It's not like, you know, the situation demanded it. And so we did it. It's not like once things get better, then we will again start, you know, just doing online. We might do blending way, definitely, but we would love to communicate with the students face to face. So being effective presenter means both the ways, whether you're doing it via the online way or whether you're doing it the offline way. The other important thing is, why did I put so much of attention on this particular? I could have been talking about linguistics and language and this and that. Because the need of the hour is that it's not just the content. Our teachers are amazing. They have so much of knowledge. They have it right here. But they maybe have the passion also, but they're not able to communicate it out. So you need the combination of this, this, and this. So I'm trying to help you with the actual expressing part. So I hope I made myself clear.
Yes. Ganga Das ji is happy. He's already written. Thank you. Excellent. Sandesha ji, this is an interesting question from Dr. Joseph John. Mm-hmm. He says, I teach Divyangjan students suffering from mental health care issues. How can I tap their talents to do well in their life and career and make life wonderful for other students like them? How they can communicate well with the normal people and do well in academics too. Please give me some tips. I think, Sandesh, I forgot to mention that you're also into speech therapy learning for the hearing impaired.
So quickly,
sign language, yes. Yeah.
So quickly, everybody, this is the sign, Indian sign language for saying thank you. So all of you can do this. Yes, ma'am knows this. So this is the sign for thank you in Indian Sign Language. So I'm not an expert in it, honestly speaking. The Linguistic Empowerment Cell has a wonderful teacher. Her name is Dr. Shehna Samantra. She's actually a guest faculty. She's amazing. I mean, we don't have a permanent position. I wish we had one. And she is the one who actually introduced us to this. All right. Now, coming to the particular question which sir talked about. What was his name again, sir's name?
Dr. Joseph John. Joseph John.
Dr. Joseph John, this is such a coincidence, sir. You know what happened? I just finished off with my sessions day for yesterday. Like, for example, I'm going to have a summer school program. So I had to finish my normal LEC online classes after one particular presentation evaluation. I told my students, this is the last day. So everybody was there towards the end. They were like, oh, ma'am, this. We loved it. We loved, you know, this was the one thing that made us want to get up and actually do something. So that was like nice, because for me as a teacher, also, teaching was actually helping me to also get up and have a purpose apart from my family chores. Now, the interesting thing which happened was yesterday, I get a call from one of the girls. She says, ma'am, you know, I wanted to tell you something. I said, yes, I was making breakfast actually. And then she said, ma'am, I'm actually going through a depression. The minute she said that, I was like, what? You know, because obviously right now the situation is that we have to be there. I'm not an expert. I have no knowledge of how to handle depressing, you know, anything to do with depression. But a little bit of knowledge that we have by, you know, reading materials and everything. So you have to be a very good listener. All you need to do is just patiently listen to the people. So I listened to her and then she told me, ma'am, in your class, we used to do all these activities. So exactly what you're saying, all these activities, for example, right now, if you can see my background, if I actually create a virtual background, I'll just quickly show this to everybody. This is something which I forgot to say earlier. See, this is for my daughter's textbook, because I was talking to the English language teachers, the school teachers. I was telling them one good way of art integrated language learning thing is that you could tell them, okay, this is a story. You create groups of 3-4 people and you tell them, okay, why don't you, if you understood this story, you create the scene. And they create the scene and they create the dialogues, okay? So then through the Zoom thing, virtual thing, or even through WhatsApp or whatever, they can send recordings where they're using their creativity to come about. So this is something from the book itself. So create some kind of activity for the students to develop. Something where people, you know, students need to talk to other students. Students need to interact with their teachers. You all as teachers have to create those kind of, you know, particular activities, debate, maybe, you know, some kind, you know, Dr. Sonu Saini, the person who actually taught me a lot about Zoom and everything. He is for the Center for Russian Studies. He has already done like the song competition in Russian. He's done a debate competition in Russian. He's done amazing work. So I'm sure all of you can also come up with something wonderful. Ma'am, any other question?
Yes. I think I'll just take one or two quick questions. I think they all connect. There is this question from Dr. Rupali. She's asking, how can we prepare questions on menti.com site, or is there any other site on which we can do the same? I will also take one more question, Sadisha ji. This is from Dr. Anamika. She's asking, my query is how to teach students group participation while teaching team building approach in virtual classes.
Okay, team building, I think I kind of answered it right now, but not a problem. Ma'am, team building, excellent. So what I did was, remember I told you, if you're using Zoom, please learn how to use breakout rooms, okay? Breakout rooms means you can either create the groups yourself. You can choose who are the 4 or 5 people who will be in one group, or you can just do it automatically. That means Zoom itself will just take randomly any 4 or 5 people and put them in a different group. For example, I have 20 students, all right? And I want to create 5 breakout rooms. So it'll have breakout room 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Each room will have four students. I will, before I put them in the breakout room, I will give them a task. It's the same thing that you would do in a classroom. This is why I love Zoom. The interactive Zoom is amazing. And when you give them an activity, you tell them, okay, after 20 minutes, we will all come back to the main room. This is the main room, for example, okay? And then what you do as a teacher, you just don't sit lay back like this. No, you have to keep going inside each room. You have to keep quiet. They'll know that you're here. I mean, they'll know that you're there inside the room, but you're listening, okay? And you keep doing this. You keep exiting and entering, exiting and entering. After 20 minutes, 2 minutes before it's 20 minutes, there is a message box, right? A chat box. You can type over there. Everybody going to get back to the main room in 2 minutes. And anyway, automatically also, once you press the button, it in 1 minute's time, everybody is pulled into the main room. So this is a wonderful thing. So I did this activity about who to save. Okay. I made them imagine that they all are in a boat and all, like, so for example, 4 or 5 people are one group. That means they are one person and they have to save 6 people out of 12 people. 6 people out of 12 people, and each of those 12 people is somebody else. Like somebody is a CM, somebody is the mother, somebody is a scientist, somebody is something, okay? And then the group is told, tell me now, why did you people choose these 6 people and not those 6 people? And do you know how this team building activity is? It's amazing because they all have to listen to each other. They have to learn how to negotiate because, for example, I might want to save the mother of 6 children. Another person will say, no, let's save the scientist. Another person will say, no, let's save this person. So they're learning how to listen and to also convince somebody. It's a beautiful activity. So it's not only about the activity. It is how, what tools you're using, what kind of impact you're able to create. That's what I would say. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, Sandeshaji, thank you. And there's another two connected quick questions. This is from Dr. Ashish. He's asking, how can we remove publicly speaking hesitation? Probably he means public speaking hesitation. And another question by Dr. Kalpana, that how do we engage participants maximally, both online and offline? I think we learned a lot today for online from you.
See, one thing is there, you know, you don't have to tell people everything. You just have to show them. I didn't do a theoretical thing. I mean, I did a practical thing. I actually showed you people. I spent time in creating that mentee quiz and actually getting you people to participate. One good thing is there is a link. If Mubin ma'am allows me, I will give the link to her. She will share the link with all of you. If you click on it, it will teach you how to make mentee. All right. Is that good? One more thing. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Please.
Yeah. Okay, so quickly, one thing I want to tell you. When you want to prepare the quiz for Menti, you don't type www.menti.com. You have to type mentimeter.com. I'm just putting it in the chat box, mentimeter.com. You have to type mentimeter.com. And also, I'm going to give a link to
email ID. If they have any further queries, our participants could get in touch with you.
Yeah, ma'am, before you shut me off, because I know I'm kind of late, I just want to show you all one thing. We don't have time for this, but this is what would happen generally. If you had time, these are the kind of questions and the feedback that I'm getting. For example, somebody asked over here. So this is a very good way for all of you. For example, Zoom is interactive, but I have been invited to Cisco webinars and different other webinars. I don't find that kind of quick, you know, the chat sometimes is a problem. So always prepare a link ready and get them. For example, somebody has already asked, Rupali Sharma asked this question about mentee. Somebody asked about speaking articulation. If I have time, I'll reply back in the email. Somebody virtual backgrounds and all these things. Yeah. So these are the ways to kind of, you know, interact. I'm talking about more of interaction with the people. Okay.
Yeah, Dr. Sadesha, just could you please flash your email ID before I invite my colleague for a formal vote of thanks so that the participants could make a note of your email ID?
Yes. So my name is Sandesha Raipa @jnu.ac.in, right? Thank you so much, Mukman. I hope it was worth it while for everyone.
Yeah, of course. Thank you so much, Sandesha ji. And it was an excellent session. And we could gain a lot. We could learn a lot. Now, I would request and I would invite my colleague and my team, my co-team, Dr. Anupriya, to please come and deliver the formal vote of thanks. Dr. Anupriya.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Mubin ma'am. Respected speaker, Dr. Sandesha Raipa, respected principal, sir, Dr. V.K. Arora, coordinator IQAC, Dr. Vinita Thilli, program coordinator, Dr. Anjali Gupta, convener, and all committee members and dear participants. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a word of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of PRHD College, University of Delhi, extend a very hearty word of thanks to our respected guest speaker, Dr. Sandesha Raipa, who blessed us with her presence and took out valuable time out of her busy schedule. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for Dr. Raipa for her work in the areas of language empowerment using digital technologies. She enlightened the participants about the life skills needed in this 21st century to deal with the current challenges in education. I feel that her lecture will be immensely helpful to all of us to overcome these communication challenges. Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a powerful and thought-provoking lecture and excellent coverage of the topic. I also wish to extend my gratitude to our respected principals, sir, who have always been a guiding force and motivation behind all successful events, Dr. Vinita Thilli, program convener, and Dr. Anjali Gupta, co-convener, and all the team members, including our technical team. Also, a sincere thanks to all the participants for being a part of this workshop. Have a good day. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes. Okay, Ravinder? Okay, we have a break of 2 minutes.
And we'll resume at 3:30.
Okay, great. Thank you. Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Welcome you all to this last session of the 3 days faculty development, online faculty development program. For the session, we have with us Dr. Rajiv Ratan Shah. Sir is at present working as an assistant professor at IIT Delhi, teaching deep learning based multimedia systems. Sir has a PhD in computer science from National University of Singapore. Sir is a M.Tech and MCA in Computer Application from Delhi Technological University, Delhi, and Jawaharlal Nehru University, respectively. Dr. Shah is having a BSc degree in Mathematics from Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. Sir has received several awards, including the prestigious European Research Consortium for Informatics and Mathematics Fellowship. He was a runner-up in Grand Challenge competition of ACM International Conference on Multimedia. Sir is involved in organizing and review of many top international conferences and journals. Since December 2016, Sir has spent 1 year as a research fellow in Living Analytics Research Center at Singapore Management University, Singapore. His areas of research interest include multi-model semantics and sentiment analysis of user-generated social media content. We welcome you, sir, for this session on leveraging artificial intelligence in digital education. Thank you, sir, for being the part of this faculty development program. Over to you now for the session, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Anjali, and thank you so much, Manvendra, and all the organization committee. It's my honor to be present my talk here. So let me share my screen. So can you see my screen?
Yes, sir. It's visible and you are audible, and sir, your screen is visible, sir. Thank you.
Wonderful. Okay, so let me get started. Again, thank you so much, everyone. And it is my privilege and honor to present my talk here. So the title for my talk is Leveraging Multimedia Data and AI in Digital Education. And little introduction about myself, as already given. So I mainly leading the Midas lab in IIIT Delhi. I will be covering more details about it, what work we are doing. Yeah, so just a correction. My affiliation is IIIT Delhi, not IIT Delhi. Yeah, so COVID-19 impacts education in India. So we all know COVID-19 heavily affected the health situation in all over the world, especially in India. These days we are having so many cases. But it has several side effects. In a sense, it is also affecting education very, very significantly. And that results in loss is in learning. It also increase dropout rates, because many students goes to college. That's how they learn. I mean, many students also, their parents send to schools because the midday meal is provided to them. That's how somehow it is also improving their health and living style. So in addition to learning, it is also kind of affecting their health in normal days. But now due to COVID-19 situation, it is very, very bad. So in India, I mean, especially in India, we already have unequal education system where, I mean, there is a huge difference between the rich people and the poor people. And so the resources in terms of devices, because when we are talking about digital education, I mean, you need some resources, you need some, equipments to continue with online education. Suppose we are going to study on Zoom, I mean, probably it is not possible for us, at least for the people who are living in locality where basically they don't have a very good internet connection. And often, I mean, you cannot study everything on mobile. I mean, in that case, probably you need to have access of laptops and the computers and so on. So not many people have access to that. And especially many students who rely on publicly available services like library, research labs, or a computer lab, the people don't have such resources, such facility with them. They take benefit of such system. I mean, now which is somehow heavily affected. So for example, I mean, despite the lockdown started somewhere in the end of March, but the education institutions closed even much earlier. So education institution is basically the one which first shut down and probably the last one which will be resuming. So in a way, I mean, the education is heavily affected due to COVID situation. So it also has a lot of side effect on the health due to online education, because if you continuously learning, studying everything on computer, so probably it may affect your mental stress, it may probably affect your eyes and so on. So due to lockdown situation, I mean, the competitive examination and academic sessions are also delayed. So at least in IIIT Delhi, it is delayed by a month, but I know in many IITs, it is delayed by at least 3 months, 4 months and so on, because they have just started their semester once the lockdown is started. It is also increasing in the unemployment. So that is, there are several students from our institute or probably many other institute, they are losing their jobs and internship because the company is giving the reason, I mean, they cannot basically hire the students for the job they were looking for. And in normal days, I mean, all the institutions have student counseling operations. So now this is also heavily affected because as part of student learning, as part of education, we also need to take care of well-being of the students, so which is also heavily affected. So teaching is moving online and or kind of on an untested and precedent scale, because in India, we have never had, in fact, probably in many part of the world, I mean, never had such a huge scale online study. And but I believe, I mean, this is an opportunity for us, like, take this as a learning, and probably we should also have mechanisms so that in case any situation like COVID-19 come again, we should be ready with online education. So I mean, despite there are several issues, there are issues with the digital turn in education. So as I mentioned, since the closed institutions are shut down, so there is unavailability of the in-person teaching, personalized feedback. So all these are very, very useful when the schools are open. I mean, the students can go to meet instructor, the teaching assistant to clarify whatever the doubts the person have. Similarly, in India specifically, we have scarcity of teaching and teachers and teaching assistant. So in online situation, it is also even getting worse because we already had the scarcity of the such teaching environment. Now due to online situation, it is even getting worse. So how basically, I mean, because all these are challenges are causing us, we need to find some alternative solutions. Like, as I mentioned, different people have different issues. Like some people have issue with bandwidth, internet bandwidth. Some people have security and privacy issue, because there is a recent publication which mentioned that the online platform like Zoom, I mean, basically they have security breach, privacy issue and so on. So definitely it comes with a benefit, but at the same time, probably it costs us. We have to be careful and so on. So similarly, difficulty in access the content within the content. When I say the within the content, because often we deal with the videos. Suppose you have a lecture video of 2 hours and you need to find a specific topic in that video. In that case, basically you need to either go, whole video and try to find the specific content. So which is not feasible, if you have 2-hour, 3-hour video. So oftentimes you only want to find the topic which probably you have doubts. So suppose after having this talk, someone want to refer, in which part basically the speaker A was talking about topic B. So in that case, you have to go manually. There is no transcription available. So through which you can find where basically a particular topic has been covered. So, so these are the difficulty with traditional, I would say the traditional digital education. So we need to find some solution for that. Similarly, difficulty in data collection, analysis and evaluation. So since I belong to computer science background, so we also need to do a lot of data collection, perform analysis and finally perform the evaluation. I believe, this might be the case with other stream as well. So now it is totally stopped because I cannot go out and collect the data. So that has also heavily affected. So it's kind of my research is shut down. I'm not able to produce any useful work. Similarly, the lack of advanced devices for many. So like many people don't have, but being as an instructor, I cannot create such gap between them. I need to basically restructure my content in such a way that it will help all kind of people, all kind of students, like whether they have low bandwidth or internet bandwidth or the high internet bandwidth, whether they have laptop, whether they don't have laptop. So the problem is, right now we never had experienced such kind of issues. So that's why our course structure is not designed. Our course structure, at least in all the universities I'm aware of, not designed as to support online education. So probably as the coming semester will be coming, in that case, we will have to design our course structure very, very carefully so that it can benefit both all kind of students, whether they have devices, they don't have your devices, whether they have low bandwidth, high bandwidth, and so on. So finally, difficulty to study courses which involves practical experience. So again, consider the case of medical, right? Medical education. In that case, the students have to perform some experiment, and often they are given the they basically brought to the operation theater. They've been shown how the operation is happening and so on, how the stitches is doing and so on. But now, they don't have access to that. Is there any way? Because only the video, looking at the videos is not helpful, because they also need to have some practical experiment. Suppose they also need to learn what are the part they need to do it. Suppose they have to start with first cleaning the wound and then probably doing the stitching, or how long they need to wait, what are the vaccination they need to use and what are the medicine they need to use it and so on. So, there is always a fixed timing for everything. So only looking at the videos will not help you. In that case, probably you need some system which can basically provide the feedback in between. So these feedback basically will help you to learn the right thing at the right time. Given the constraint we have. So this will basically, part of emulation, I would say. Many times, suppose you are doing the operation of some part. In that case, can we do some kind of 3D modeling for that, so that you can just give in the picture. Give me one picture. I will convert, I will make a 3D modeling for that, and you can perform the surgery on that 3D modeling. So in this way, basically, we need to find the solutions to basically address the challenges that we are facing in digital turn in education, the digital education that we're talking about. The solutions would be, we need to basically leverage, we need to utilize all the existing resources, all the existing technology that we are currently have. So for instance, so right now, advances in digital recording technology can help us in collecting the high quality videos, which can basically can be disseminated to different, So which can be disseminated to different people based on their internet bandwidth. So for example, so right now, suppose the person, my student sitting in Delhi has high internet bandwidth, I can send him the high HD video. But suppose my student who went back to Bihar and may not have very high internet bandwidth, in that case, I can lower the resolution of the video again, so we can find the what could be the optimal resolution and can be sent to the person. So it's kind of, we need to adaptively change the video quality and send it to the respective person. In this way, while recording, you can have the high quality video, and while disseminating to different students, different people, you can send based on their internet bandwidth they have. Similarly, advances in digital streaming technology. So this is somehow I already covered. So access to course material and the content from the expert across the world. So one of the major benefit of online education is that you can access the high quality materials, high quality content from different top university across the world. But I mean, it also have some limitation in a sense. Probably I'm basically a L2 learner. So English is kind of second language for me. If some very, very top professor in USA, I mean, he's teaching something, his accent is very, very different. I mean, probably it is very difficult for me to understand that accent. Is there any way through which we can convert his American accent speech to Indian accent so that I can understand? So this is one of the example through which we can computer science term, we call it transfer learning. So it's kind of basically we are style transfer. We are doing the style transfer from American accent to Indian accent. So because if something which is covered in Indian accent, probably it is easier for me to understand the given topic. Similarly, there is already publicly available tool and services like Google Form translation. So through Google Form, probably I can create the survey like the previous speaker was showing. All the data was collected through Google Form. So Google Form is in a way helping us to collect the data. Similarly, translation, Google Translation is there to translate from content from one language to another language. Similarly, the transcription. So for a given speech, you can convert the speech to text, because for computers, it cannot process the speech directly. We need to convert the speech signal to the text so that the computer can understand the semantic meaning of the speech. So for example, if you are saying something to Alexa, Alexa, please play a song. Alexa, please tell me how's the weather today? What is the temperature today? So in that case, Alexa internally kind of convert the given speech to text. And once it is converted to text, it has structured information, it has semantic meaning, and it can basically further retrieve the data and give back the result to you. Similarly, there are other platforms like Meet, Classroom, Zoom, Skype, and which can help you in several ways. There are several limitations of existing tools. So for example, Google Form. So Google Form basically can create a form which has a number of questions, and every questions can basically the user can read and just answer that. But my experiment warned that I don't want student to spend more than 30 seconds for question A, 35 seconds say for question B, and so on. In this way, I mean, I want some customization in a sense. I mean, a whole form should finish in 30 minutes. So Google Form currently don't provide me that. So, I mean, in that case, probably we also need to come up with some customized tools for that. So that could be in terms of course management, it could be in terms of content delivery, it could be for conducting fair examination and evaluation. Because one of the major concern which has been raised by most of my colleagues, how to conduct the fair exam? I mean, because suppose you send a question paper to student basically gone through the exam and just upload the whatever the answer sheet it is. How we can verify that whether it was indeed the student or someone else? I mean, we don't have any ways to basically check that. I mean, only the brute force method, or you can say the simplest method can people think of. He will say, okay, so I have fixed the examination timing and everyone have to turn on the video. And in that case, basically you'll have to, the instructor or the teaching assistant have to regularly look at all the videos and see whether someone is cheating or not, right? So this is, I mean, one of the big hassle that nobody want to go, especially the instructor having say 600 students in a class or 300 students in a class, it's not possible. So like for next semester, I will be having 300 students in my course. And if I have to conduct a fair examination, I cannot follow that like for a given duration of the examination, I ask everyone, okay, so turn on video and we will continuously look at. So it is not feasible at all. So it means probably we need some customized way to conducting exam rather than simply Google form, like create a question and you need to finish it. I mean, rather I want to give, okay, for a given time frame, you need to finish this exam. And we need some automated way. We need some automated way to basically verify whether the student is cheating or not. Similarly, I mean, especially in case of online education, it is very, very difficult for many of us to evaluate all the answer set. Is there any way, is there a computer scientist can help, or probably the artificial intelligence can help us in evaluating the given answer sheet? Is there a way we can do so? So like in case of structured information, like for a given question A, there are four options and answer B is correct. It's a kind of rule-based thing you can simply evaluate. But how about evaluating something like essay? Can you just write an essay and ask computer to grade this? Similarly, given a speech, just like TOEFL, many of you probably have given TOEFL. So suppose I give TOEFL exam. Is there any way we can basically assess or grade the whatever I'm speaking? So it means, these involve too much subjectivity. So is there any way with some accuracy, can we evaluate this? So this is something I will be covering in my further slides. So what we are doing. So especially in case of digital education, so we have access to huge amount of multimodal information. So when I say multimodal information, we have access to audio, we have access to video, and probably whenever the student is writing something on the given screen or something, we have access to images and probably the text as well. So it means we have access to huge amount of multimodal information to conduct a fair, build a basically fair education system. So to answer all those, up to some extent AI can help. So in the coming slides, I will be try to cover some of the things, like how we can do automatic proctoring tool. Can we basically build some automatic scoring and feedback system? Because one of the major issue with online education, student may not get the feedback on what they are doing. Suppose I write an essay. So on the essay, is there any way we can get the feedback from the computer? Okay, so probably you are doing too many spelling mistakes, your verb is, you are making a lot of grammatical mistakes, or probably your sentence is too long, or probably, you're not following the correct structure. Is there any way to do so? So, that basically we can do through AI. So especially in case where the student do not have access to actual teachers. The aim of using AI is not replacing teachers, but also just filling the gap. Because as I mentioned in the beginning of the talk, so we have scarcity of teachers. We have we do not have enough teachers. Similarly, students probably are many times they are shy. They don't want to contact teachers most of the time. So probably they want to have something, which they can learn by themselves, kind of self-learning with some feedback. So AI somehow can help there. Similarly, helping. In the previous talk also, we were discussing about helping the people with disabilities. Is there any way we can help those students in online education learning? So is there any way we can provide some useful feedback to them? So this is something, I will also be covering in the coming slides. So this is a kind of very, it's kind of overview which I'm going to cover. So I want to make this talk not just monotonous. So please feel free to ask any questions in between if it is fine with administrator. Otherwise you can write down all the question, and so I see some hand, raise hand. If you have any question, please ask. Should I continue, or should we have the question? Should we answer question in the end of the session, or should I continue with the presentation?
Please continue. We'll ask the questions at the end.
Okay. Sure. Thanks. So this is about my lab. So my lab stands for Multimodal Digital Media Analysis Lab. So from the name itself, we deal with multimodal data, digital media, digital data like images, video, and so on. So these are my students, wonderful students. They are doing great work. So this is my team. So I have 6 PhD students, and these are some masters master BTech student who are working with us, and most of alumnus from our lab have been placed to both in academia and industry, like top places like CMU, Columbia, and companies like Google, Microsoft, and so on. So our lab believe in working collaboratively with top people. So we working very very closely with partners in industry as well as academia. So as part of my lab, I mean, we mainly focus on, as in our research, we focus on AI for social good. And in our system, basically, we utilize the natural language processing and multimedia based system for society. And especially they are focusing on education and healthcare. These two are the main direction that we are working on. So we are working on automatic speech recognition. So for a given speech, we convert to text. And similarly, I mean, many things are already, you can say, available through Google or probably some other companies. Like, then why do we need to do so? Why do we need to create our own? So there are several reasons. So firstly, I mean, existing system working very well for English, but not for Indian languages and many other local languages. And secondly, I mean, they basically charge a huge amount of money if you're going commercial. So in that case, I mean, we cannot utilize their, the APIs. So we need our own local system. So that is the reason we are creating our own ASR for Indian languages. Similarly, we have visual speech recognition and construction. So when I say the visual speech recognition, so for a given video, we try to understand what the person is saying, and the reconstruction refers to we reconstruct the speech for the given lip movement, given visual movement. So, I mean, these are some of work we are doing, and these are some publications we have made to these venues. These are some awards that we received in last 3 years of after founding my lab. So yeah, so motivation about how the multimedia data can be useful. So as I have covered in the previous slide, so when we are doing digital education, you have the data in form of text, you have data in the form of images, you have data in the form of videos, audio, and animation, and so on. So in a sense, I mean, you already have multimedia. So multimodality referring to the text, image, video, and so on. And it's a huge amount of data. So for instance, I mean, in this call itself, we have close to 250, 300 participants, and everyone having the video modality, video data with us. Is there any way to somehow find out whether the students are, or not student, I would say the participants are paying attention to the talk or not? Is there any way we can automatically judge that? Or probably can we give some score to that? So, I mean, the big data analytics, image processing and machine learning AI can help use that. Similarly, the data source, so we can have the data from different sources. So it could be from social media, it could be from traditional media, or probably the platform like Zoom and so on. Similarly, so in a way, I mean, multimedia is increasingly becoming the biggest data, biggest big data. So we have huge amount of multimedia data and can multimodal data. So can we utilize that data for improving education, healthcare, e-commerce, and so on? So, I mean, as mentioned in my introduction, I'm also actively participate in organizing conference. So I'm very happy that this year I was able to bring one of the popular conference of multimedia called International Conference of Multimedia Big Data Big MM to Delhi. So this year this conference is happening in Delhi itself, but unfortunately due to COVID situation the conference is turned into the virtual. So in terms of dates, so like most of the dates are over, but we're still accepting workshop and grand challenge papers, and we will be having several keynote from experts. So if you have any paper willing to submit, please submit or ask me if you have any questions later on. So these are the some details. So this conference is co-organized by top people in the multimedia and the AI community. So like Professor Zimmerman, Santanu Chaudhary, many of us probably you know, Dr. Amesh Jain, similarly Dr. Mohan Kankanhalli, and so on. So the themes are mainly limited to the multimedia big data. And of course, I mean, it probably you'll be using AI and machine learning to build that. So since most of this talk, the remaining talk is going to talk about AI machine learning related, how the AI machine learning can help in solving different system. So I want to give a very brief introduction about data science. I totally understand. I mean, different participants are from different area. So may not be the AI is well suitable for them. That's why I will not go into too much technical details, but rather I will mainly focus on the motivation and how AI can helpful and so on. So I have provided the link of my papers and the materials. If you want to go further in technical details, or probably ask me offline after the talk. So when we say the data scientists, we need data scientists because we have huge amount of data, multimedia data, as we discuss as part of online education that we are having. So if we basically want to derive some useful information from the given data, so that's how the role of data scientists come into the picture. And the data scientists, what they do, basically they need to have the knowledge of machine learning. They should understand the analytical functions. They need to ability to work with unstructured data from the various sources like video, social media, and so on. And in a way, I mean, he should be good in programming and probably database and so on. So this is a kind of very win. This is a kind of Venn diagram for data science. A data scientist kind of having some knowledge of computer science, some of mathematics and computer science, mathematics and statistics. And they need to have basically some domain information because they need to apply the computer science and math skills that they have on some kind of given data. Suppose if it is data for medical domain, so the data scientist need to have some information about the data's medical domain so that he can solve the problem related to medical domain. So I would like to give a very brief difference between AI, machine learning, and DL, deep learning, because oftentimes people get confused what they are. So in a very layman term, I would say the artificial intelligence is a technique which enables machine to mimic human behavior. So it's kind of try to mimic how the people say score given essay, how the person scores some given speech, or and so on. Similarly, machine learning is a kind of subset of AI, and it's basically which use statistical method to enable functions to improve with experience. So it's kind of machine learning is a kind of function you'll have. So for a given input, for a given output, you'll try to learn how the thing should be. So for example, I will give you the example of supervised machine learning. In that case, I will give example of 10 images of cat, and I will tell my machine, okay, so this is image of cat. So next time when I just give another image of cat, so ideally the machine should able to tell this is the picture of cat. And finally, the deep learning. So deep learning is again subset of machine learning, which make the computation of multi-layer neural network feasible. So it's basically it resembles how the human's neuron work. So it's a kind of, you can say, the similar to the composite function where different layers are there to reach to the from given input to the take the final decision. So this is a very broad difference between AI, machine learning, and deep learning. So first part as part of the first talk of my talk, I will be covering improving digital education through lip reading system. So lip reading is recognizing what is being spoken from video input without any audio. So once you have the silent video, because the video is without audio. So once you have the silent video, you can convert the silent video to text, or probably you can convert to audio, or you can convert to video with audio. So in a way, basically you can reconstruct lip reading as a text problem, lip reading as a speech problem, lip reading for pathology, and adding new classes in lip reading. So in the context of education, I will be briefly discussing how it can be useful in education. It has many, many other applications. For example, it can be useful in surveillance. Suppose CCTV feeds capturing some of the conversation between two suspects. Only based on the video, you cannot understand what they're saying. But if we have their lip movement, can we somehow determine what they were discussing, were they suspect or not? In fact, in US, some of the sentences has been done based on the lip reading. So there were expert lip reader who for a given video, basically they understand they were talking about something, and based on that, the judge has given the sentence. So it means if we have this, so it can very, very useful in surveillance. But let's get back to the context of education, how it useful in education. Suppose some person is not able to speak. And they need to discuss with some of their classmates, some of their basically other teachers who probably expert in lip reading. They're not expert lip reader. In that case, can our system help them I mean, understand what the student, disabled physically challenged student is asking. So in a way that can help there. So I will show you some of the example. So again, I am not sure, I mean, whether we can ask people here, but let me show you some examples, how the silent video are and can we basically determine what the person has said. So suppose you have given four options. I'm going to play this video. So probably in the chat, people in the chat, basically people can comment what they understand, what the person is going to say. So here, basically, I want you to be a lip reader for this particular person. So please pay attention to this video. And once you determine what the person has said, please type in the chat box. Any guess? Okay, so I can see some chat. People, most of the people say conflict. Okay, so conflict is a wrong answer. So what, let me basically play the video in the slow motion. And so I'm going to play the video in slow motion. Please try again. Okay, so we have, so now the people are some kind of, most of the people are guessing correct now. Yeah. So let me play the real video, then probably you can get the answer and understand whether you were right or not. Yeah, so basically it was conference. The person said conference. I mean, if you look at the video, I don't know if you are able to listen the sound, but the person is saying conference. So if you are not able to listen the sound, just take my word, the student said conference. So this is lip readings that we have made through our AI program. So I believe it's difficult to ask for every question. So let me just play this. So the person is basically said speech. If you want to confirm, just see again, the person said speech. So in this way, I mean, through our program, through our AI model, we are able to determine what the person has said based on the lip movement with some percent probability that you can see. So here, I mean, let's change the setting from Kaun Banega Crorepati with four options to probably so many options, because to the model, to the computer model, only four options are not given. I mean, it has a huge vocabulary, right? So in that case, probably let me try again. So this is the last lip reading question I am asking. So please look at the video and please tell me what the person is saying. Any guess? Let me play again. Okay, so people saying conflict. So I feel no guess. Okay, let me play in the slow motion. Can you see now? Okay. So basically the person said difficult. Let me, probably you can see the motion again, lip movement again. So the person said difficult. So the word was indeed difficult, I would say. So in this way, based on the lip reading, you can at least help students, if you're talking about education context, by understanding what question they are asking. Similarly, it can not only help the, I mean, the people who cannot speak, but it can also help people basically who have difficulty in speaking, right? For example, the people suffering from dysarthria, the people suffering from aphasia. So they have difficulty in saying something. So it is not possible, because the parents of these students, these kids, they want to send these students not to the special school, but to the common school, normal school. In that case, I mean, it's very difficult for the teachers and the fellow student to understand what they're saying. So in this case, if we have some AI system which can infer what the student was saying, so it will be create a better environment, I would say better collaborative environment between special child and probably the other candidates. So that was covers lip reading to text, for a given silent video, we convert to text. So this is the first part. In the second part, what we have done, so many times it happens if you are converting the silent video to text, it is language dependent because it need to be, it will basically work on special set of words. So it's not scalable in a sense. So can we do something like you cannot listen to that. So if you cannot listen to that, you don't know what the person has said. You want to communicate with a person who cannot hear. In that case, or probably cannot see as well. In that case, basically, if we can create the sound for a given lip movement, it will be easier to communicate. So in this work, what we have done, for a given lip movement, we convert the lip movement to speech. So let me play this video. So I don't know if you are able to listen. So the person said, excuse me. So this sound which I played is generated by our model, AI model. Similarly, this person is saying, thank you. So whatever the speech reconstruction model that we have, so it basically not just any traditional, I would say, the text to speech system, because the text to speech system look like robotics voice. It's kind of, so in our case, we have generated the human voice. For example, if you give me the sound of, say, Amitabh Bachchan, so I will learn from Amitabh Bachchan, and using this lip movement, I will generate the sound with Amitabh Bachchan's voice, kind of thing. So this is about for a given lip movement to speech generation. So the next part, so just to show, our work is language independent. This person basically said ni hao ma. So ni hao ma is hello in Chinese. So this speech is generated using our AI model. And this is, I don't know if you're able to listen this, but this is very, very, at least you can infer what the person is saying. Like the person is right now saying, xie xie. Xie xie is kind of thank you in Chinese. So our model, despite it is trained on English, it is working well for Chinese. And similarly, this is for Hindi. So we have generated the reconstructed speech in Hindi as well. So the person said, haji. So as next part, what we have done, so as part of the next part in lip reading, what we have done, if you give me one image, suppose you given me this still image, and if you give me the audio, so in that case, what I will do, I will generate the whole video for you. So kind of, I will create the lip movement for you. So it's very similar to the deep fake, I would say, if you have heard of. So in that case, given lip movement, given still image of the person and audio, I will generate the whole video for you. So in this case, you can think of the scenario I was talking about. Suppose one of my student is in one of the rural area where he does not have very good internet bandwidth. So this system basically can help rather than sending whole packet, a whole video to the student, he will just say the still image and probably the audio for some part. Similarly, you can say the different video segment. In this way, you can, rather than sending say 30 MB, you are just sending say 1 MB. So in this way, despite having the lower bandwidth, he can understand, or you can grasp the whole video. So in our further experiment that we have published, submitted to one of the top conference. So where what we have done, we have basically dropped the different frames in the video at very, very regular interval. And that is in ratio of say 20%, 80%, 50% and so on. So even with dropping the frames by 70, 80%, we were able to create the video, which is perceptually well. You can understand what the person is saying with the video. So it's kind of, we are compressing the whole video by 70% with keeping the perceived meaning. So this is the way basically we have done. So we have generate for a given for a given image. So when we talking about the video, so in video the different component is called visemes. It's kind of the similar thing of phonemes when you're dealing with the audio. So we try to learn this mapping and generate the different visemes for the given phonemes. So in this way we have generated the whole video, and this is the example you can see. So this is the one simplest thing you can do the viseme concatenation. So the person is saying goodbye. So if you see the lip movement, so it is kind of you can see the stitches. It's kind of because we are just concatenating the different frames. So in that case it's not smooth, but in case of what we have generated, if you see here, so it's a kind of very smooth. Like for every phoneme and the frames between two phonemes, we have generated the frame. So it looks smooth rather than it's kind of look humanistic rather than robotics. So this is the similar thing that we have created for Aap Kaise Hain. And this is its video. So this is about lip reading. So what we have done based on the lip movement, we have generated the text, speech and video, and through which you can help in education in several ways, helping the physically challenged student. You can help with the student sitting in the location where the internet bandwidth is not too good, and so on. So the next work that we have done, improving digital education through touchless typing system. So you may heard of, basically you can type, you may speak something, but there are many scenarios, especially say, talking about the person who cannot speak. In that case, is there any way he can ask some question? So in that case, basically, we have built a system through which, based on your head movement, gesture, we create the word what you want to ask. Like if you see here, we have the QWERTY keyboard, and suppose person want to say love. So in that case, he will look at the words, the characters that you have in the keyboard like this. First he look at this, then he look at this, and look at this, and look at that. So it's kind of, we have divided the whole keyword into 9 clusters, and the person simply have to look at the clusters. So based on our deep learning methods, so you can generate basically in this case, we try to determine the cluster sequence. So like for the given word live, the sequence will be 6371. So 6371 is the sequence he look at. And after that, once you know the sequence, you have basically narrowed down the possible words. So once you found the sequence, the possible words could be love, live, and so on. So in this way, you can determine what the person is saying. So again, this is one of the preliminary work result that we are showing. Still a lot of things has to be done. Using AI, we can basically type without touching anything. Just looking at your hand, movement, we can determine what you're saying. So the next part that we are doing, in fact, we are working this particular system for NGO called iSaksham, located in Naxal affected area. So what we're trying to do here, so for a given sentence, we try to correct the grammar automatically. So this is what we have done. So in this case, basically we have just taken this existing work. This is not ours. So we have taken this existing work and train this whole machine learning system, so that once you give one incorrect sentence, our model will correct that sentence. So I'm running out of time, I will just skim through this part. So in this way, what we have done, so we have 1 billion word benchmark. So last sentence level English corpus. So deleting, adding, replacing, and shuffling some tokens to make noisy labels. So in this way, you have mapping of correct word to incorrect sentence to incorrect sentence. So in a way, we teach computer, look, this is the correct sentence, this is the incorrect sentence. And you need to learn this kind of mapping in a such a way that later on, if I give you one incorrect sentence, you need to give me the correct sentence for that. So far, this particular work is giving, I would say, acceptable level of result, but further need to be improved. So the next work I want to quickly go through is automatic short essay scoring system. So we have published some work in this direction. So what we have done, so here basically you have some prompt, and for that prompt, the some graded response are given. So we want to train our model in such a way, so later on, if you give me some ungraded response, I will produce the feedback and the grade for that. So in a way, I mean, we done all, I mean, a lot of feature extraction, model training, and so on, so that once you give me for a given prompt some essay or response, I will grade and provide the feedback. For example, this is the our result. So for a given prompt, when the person has given this particular short answer, similarly this short answer, so based on that we have different evaluation metric on which we provide the feedback. Like we provide context, whether the whatever the person has even written, is it in the context of the prompt question. Similarly, part of speech, is it correct or not. Similarly, the keywords is relevant high or not. So like similarly, prompt overlap, lexicon overlap, word use, sentence use, logical formulation, temporal. So in this, basically using this predefined criteria that we have, we can provide the feedback like whether you're doing well or not. Similarly, I mean, once you have all this, whether the person is doing well or not, you can also do the scoring. So like in this case, in our case, we have, we basically score based on the scale of 0 to 3. So in this case, we have given this score 0 because this is not relevant answer. And in this case, we have given a score of 2 because this is kind of very relevant to the ask prompt. So, very similar to the text scoring, we have also built a system for automatic speech scoring. So we use deep learning model for that. So like here we have the speech, we convert this speech to the text using our ASR system, automatic speech recognition system. And so once we have a kind of text for that, we use the speech modality, we use the text modality, and we fuse them, and using deep learning architecture that we have, we produce the grade. So it is giving quite good result, and this particular system is being used by one of the big company in US, and we have built for them. So another thing that we can do, improving digital education through automatic computation of time complexity. At least those who work in the area of computer science, they know, I mean, when we write any program, there is some computational complexity belongs to that. So in this way, basically what we have done, for these many time complexity, like order one, order log n, order n, and so on. So if you give me any program of this complexity, I will be able to tell you automatically what is the time complexity for that. Because the determining the time complexity of program is kind of not very trivial for the beginner. So in that case, I mean, the student can learn by themselves. Suppose the student said, okay, the time complexity of this is log n, and our model also says it's a log n, it's correct. But suppose the person said just log order of n square, but the model says order n, it's kind of get the feedback whether you're correct or not. So I will completing the final part. So I mean, before this, I mostly covered, I mean, what are the different AI model that we have to solve different problems. So we have also built some tool which can help you in achieving that. So for example, we have built a test tool. See, if you see that, you can create different questions, and you can create the time associated with each question. Like for the question one should be 30 seconds, question two should be 20 seconds, and so on. And in Google Form, if you look at, I mean, Google Form won't allow you to record a video as a response, but because as based on the need of our system, you want the student to basically speak something. You want student to something, record their video for the answer. In this way, I mean, our customized tool basically able to do so. If you look at the video here, this is the proctoring video I was talking about. So during the whole session, we capture the video, and we can perform the automatic proctoring system for that. So we have started working on automatic proctoring, but not completed it. Similarly, we have built a tool called Audino. It's got much popular in the very popular website called Papers with Code. So where basically we have allow the user to segment different part of the video and annotate it correspondingly. So like this part is say high valence, high arousal, and so on. I mean, number of annotation that you can make. So the next thing we have done, course management tool. So basically we have, let me just quickly play this video. So many times when you are dealing with a course, it is not only limited to learning, but also limited to, it also require to basically manage courses, how the student take different courses, select different courses, can we make any course recommendation and so on. So in this case, we have built a system. Here the student can see how they are performing, what are the course we can recommend them based on their performance. So this is based on the AI model that we had and so on. Similarly, you can see the student basically select these are recommended courses. This is something new you can try. These are the courses you have. Many times you want to assist student by creating their personalized timetable. So in this tool, we have also created a way they can basically create a personalized timetable. So when you select any course, so if you see here, I mean, when the student selected some courses, it will create the personalized calendar for you. So this is, we have built for IIIT Delhi, and IIIT Delhi is going to use it from next semester. And similarly, we book another system for BookIt. So because especially in case of digital education, the university institute have very limited resources. And we want to efficiently manage how the resources should be shared by the different people in a fair manner. So in this way, I mean, if you look at, I mean, basically, we have different resources. Like right now, this particular tool is only for venue booking, but you can extend it to other kind of system, like suppose remote access to server, remote access to some simulation system, software, and so on. So in this way, you can have different times, and you can select the time slot and book it. In this way, you can, in fair manner, you can do so. Similarly, how last slide for my talk. So I'm very sorry if I'm getting late. So at least so far, based on the work I have shown, you see, I mean, the AI can help you in many ways. But usually the AI education starting in, say, graduation or probably the master level and so on. So this is very similar to the physics. When physics was there in 1800, so they, at that time it was called natural philosophy. And this course is only accessible to the, say, master student and probably the higher in higher studies. But since it was very popular, since it was very, very important, so the people thought, the government thought it should be used by not only in the higher studies, but from the, say, class six level. That's how probably we started from physics, say, seventh, eighth, or ninth and 10th and so on. So in this way, I mean, what they have done, basically, they have popularized this course in many ways to the lower level classes. So that is our aim. So how AI topics can be taught in undergrad and secondary level. So we have think of some solutions. So these are the tools we are building in. So because many young students don't know how the AI model is working. But if we build some kind of interactive tool like this, drag and drop this model and see how this model is working. Drag and drop this data set and see how this model is working. And so on. In this way, basically, you can do a number of things and so on. So in conclusion, in order to help online education, what we are doing, we are building automatic scoring of essay, speech, grammar detection, correction system for Hindi, English, Bangla. So right now we have working with Hindi and English. Bangla probably will be starting after that. So teaching how to write generative creating writing. So we are providing the feedback on the what the student is reading. Similarly, teaching code complexity, storytelling by animation and Hindi videos, building AI assisted tool to help digital education. So that's it for my talk today. And I'm very, very happy to answer any questions you have right now.
Thank you, sir. We are having a question from Mr. Raman Arora. Sir is asking that, is there a risk that the artificial intelligence will replace the teaching jobs?
No, it will not. As I said, I mean, treat this, whatever the thing we are building, as assistive technology to the teacher. So because I'm also a teacher, so I know, I mean, I don't want to build something which replaces me. So in a way, it is assisting me. As I mentioned, given the example, student probably hesitate before contacting me. So if our AI model some kind of helping them in the kind of bridging the gap between teacher and student by providing some initial feedback. So in a way, I mean, it can basically reduce the load of teacher, I would say, because as I also mentioned, the scarcity of the teacher, we all know well aware of. So this basically can help those students as well, those who do not have access to the good teachers and so on.
Okay, there's a question by Dr. Ambika Sharma. She's asking that, please, if you can throw some light on deep fake forensics also, she requests you to comment or enlighten in terms of the technical solutions to counter and verify simulation of hyper real virtual.
What is the second part you mentioned? Hyper?
Hyper real virtual, sir.
Okay. So, in order to comment on the deepfake, deepfake is banned in many countries. I mean, definitely it is very, very useful, but everything comes with a boon as well as the bad thing, right? So it is depends on the government and the people, how do they use it? Like some weapons, gun has been invented. I mean, it has good as well as bad thing. So deepfake, I would say it's very similar to that. So right now, probably people don't know how to deal with that, because in case of weapons, people know, I mean, they if they use it wrong way, I mean, they will caught and probably put behind the bar and given the sentence. But in case of, deepfake videos, there is no strict policy or created so far. So they don't know, if someone is creating deepfake, how the things will be sentenced and so on. There are many, and many times it's very difficult to find, who's the people have done, because someone has created and then shared, and it is in case of social media, it just spread like a fire, right? A wildfire. In that case, it's not possible to find all those culprits. So that's why to be on safer side, all the government, most of the government just banning it. We don't allow deepfake. So, yeah.
One last.
Hello.
Sir, there's a question from Krishna Kumar Jha, sir. He's saying that, is there any appropriate artificial intelligence technology to correct the grammar errors in Hindi language, sir?
So right now, as far as best of my knowledge, we don't have, but we have already started working on correcting Hindi grammar since last 3 to 4 months. And my wife basically is also doing PhD in Hindi. I'm also taking her help to what are the common mistakes people do in Hindi and so on. So in a sense, to the best of my knowledge, there is not any, and we are working on it, and hopefully we can deliver in next 2 months.
Okay, sir, thank you. So with this, we come to the end of questions. We don't have any other questions. I have already invited the questions twice, sir. So I now request Dr. Saeed Mumbin Zehra, ma'am, from the Department of History, to propose a vote of thanks to the session.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you. Anjali. Thank you, Dr. Anjali. Thank you, sir. I'm extremely honored to present the vote of thanks. I extend my humble thanks to Dr. Rajiv Ratna Shah for taking out time and delivering such a minute, itni bariki se apne samjhaya ek concept. We are extremely thankful to you, sir. I also take the opportunity to thank our honorable principal, who's constant guide, who's a constant source of inspiration, and his presence and support is always there with us, Dr. Kriyantosh Kumar Jha. Thank you, sir. I also like to thank our convener, Dr. Vinita Tuli, and our co-convener, Dr. Anjali Gupta, our amazing, incredible team, Dr. Anju Bajaj, Dr. Anil, Dr. Vikas, Dr. Dipankar, Dr. Raghvendra, Dr. Amit, Dr. Abid, Dr. Manvendra, Dr. Manisha, Dr. Baljeet, Dr. Anupriya, our technical team. And above all, I would like to thank Dr. V.K. Arora, our coordinator of IQAC, sir, for all the constant support that give you us. And nothing would have been possible unless and until the active participation of all the participants across the country. Thank you. You guys are wonderful. Thank you all. I feel extremely honored to extend the vote of thanks from my team webinar. Thank you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you. With this, we come to the end of the session. Thank you all. Thank you to all the participants for being there for today's session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. It is my honor to present my talks with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you
so much. Okay, Ravinder, so we come to the end of the session, today's session. Ravinder, are you there?
Ravinder,
bus. Okay. So participants, we come to the end of this today's session. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Ravinder.
Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you, Anjali ji.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ravinder, can we end the meeting?